and welcome to the May 20th Planning Board meeting. First of all, the minutes of the previous meeting, are there any additions or corrections?
No.
Move to accept.
Move to accept it.
Second.
Okay, all in favor? All right, I'd just like to list the correspondence we've had tonight, so it will go in the public record, and a number of these we got quite late this afternoon, so they're not on the sheet. But we've had a letter from Jay Betancourt regarding Comfy Cape, a letter from Kay Betancourt regarding Comfy Cape, a letter from C. Valandry regarding Comfy Cape, a letter from G. Cummings regarding a letter from Mary Brock regarding Eastman Meadows, a memorandum from the code enforcement officer regarding Eastman Meadows, Cape Farm Alliance progress report, and I'm going to go back to that in a minute, a letter from Jay Mooney regarding Comfy Cape, a letter from N. Ingalls regarding the BA district, a letter from Caroline McKenna regarding beds and breakfasts, Joe Faria regarding beds and breakfasts, Stephen Adler regarding beds and breakfasts, Edward Matterson regarding beds and breakfasts, a letter from Rick Licht of Stantect for on behalf of a Mr. Sean Tammer regarding beds and breakfasts, a letter from Lisa and Steve Gent regarding Eastman Meadows, David Sanford regarding beds and breakfasts, Mark Boulder regarding Comfy Cape, Mark and Michael Boulder regarding Comfy Cape, and David Freeman regarding beds and breakfasts. And I would just like to mention for everybody that's here and anybody who's watching us that the Cape Farm Alliance, which is a marvelous committee and has done a huge amount of work, has produced this incredible document, but I urge everybody to go online and look up their website, which is www.capeelizabethfarms.com. They've really done an amazing job in listing all the farms and what they have to offer, and they even had a great recipe for soup this month with one of the products from the farms, and they've just done a great job. So I'd like to publicly comment them and their chairwoman, Penny Jordan. It's just been terrific. Okay, first order of business tonight. Yes.
If I could be recognized for a minute, I received this evening, and I can pass it around to the board members, be happy to give you a copy, a petition that was submitted to the town hall today. Town councilors have received a copy of it. Copies will also be made for the planning board. But it's a petition signed by over 200 people that reads as follows. By signing my name below, I support the business known as Rudy's of the Cape and encourage the town council and planning board to make the necessary updates to the town ordinance to allow this neighborhood business to survive. So it's here, and I'll circulate it. I'd be happy to make copies for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anybody have anything else before we get started on the first order of business? Okay, Comfy Cape, will you please come forward and present your package.
Good evening. I'm Rachel Sennell. I'm with Gorin Turgeon Architects, and I'm representing Kimberly Newman today with the Comfy Cape Daycare. And I have a few boards, and I can also walk you through our submittal.
Do you want to put them up on the board? Is there anything to put them up with?
Well, I have boards. Let's see.
Here. Thank you, Steve.
Oh, great. Thank you.
Rachel?
Yes.
Could you state your last name again, please?
Sennell, S as in Sam, U-N-N-E-L-L.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Comfy Cape Daycare is located at the corner of Scott Dyer Road and Patricia Drive, and I have a plan here that shows existing conditions. And in your submittal, there is one other sheet that's the first 11 by 17 sheet, and it's called the Site Plan Standard Boundary Survey, and I just want to bring you to your attention that that plan represents the original conditional use submittal back in 1997. And we're here today to amend that conditional use permit. And then the next plan in your submittal is sheet L101, and that is represented by what I have on the board here, except this one, we have some photographs to show you with it. So what's existing is, we have the comfy Cape Daycare located here, the driveway, it's a curved shape that goes into the back of the building. We have the north perimeter line that has a, like a notch in it, and that's slightly different than, it was combined, slightly different than what was on the original plan. My understanding is that these two lots were originally one lot, and then when it was sold, there was this little notch put into it, and that is also on a survey that had been presented or is in the file earlier. There is a gravel area behind the parking lot, and then the existing play area here, and that existing play area is around 1,500 square feet right now. There's existing plant material, pretty mature buffer along the north property line. This upper photograph is taken from here, looking behind, showing the hedge line here, and then from Patricia Drive, looking around down the boundary line. And then another photograph to give you an idea of this, what this arborvitae hedge is if you're standing in the driveway and looking through, it screens the back north property. So today, we just want to show you the proposed improvements. There are three, well, two. One is, and I'm going to switch this around to show you the proposed improvements. This is on sheet L102 in your submittal packet. And there's an existing sign located, and there's a little, kind of where my finger is, that's where the existing sign is, and we're proposing to move that back out of the right-of-way onto the property line near the driveway. And then the proposed sign is, there's a picture of it in your packet. And the other adjustment is to keep the fence on the Patricia Drive side and the Scott Dreyer side the same as is shown in the existing condition plan, except straighten the fence out on the north side so it's a 5 feet parallel to the property line, and then bring it in to expand it towards the gravel area. So that does increase the play area. However, it's only because of a topography situation they have in the playground now. There's a slope in there, and there's very little flat play area for play equipment. And so that would just allow them to move their play equipment and adjust it to a flat area. Also in the proposed plan, it shows the required parking. We have two for the residents upstairs in the daycare center, which are located right behind the comfy Cape Daycare, right in its location. And then there's four proposed along the curve, and three of those are for staff, and one of those are for visitors. And that's really all the improvements that we're proposing at this time. Do you have some specific questions that I can answer regarding any of the improvements?
I remember reading in one of the letters, if this is the right time to ask it, that when the Comfy Cape expanded some time ago, there was some agreement that that was going to be 12 children maximum, but I don't know if that's really the case. I'm not sure I should be asking you or asking...
I read the file.
What's that?
I went in and read the old file.
And what do you remember?
The maximum number was 12.
Okay.
There was a distance of a minimum of 10 feet that had to be maintained between the edge of the pavement and the adjacent property line, and that was where the parking is. And at that time, there was a fair amount of concern about having 12 children in the property. Now, my understanding was that originally it was supposed to be children 6 to 12 years of age. At least that's what was in the original file. And then that was changed over time, but I don't know that anything ever came before the planning board, and it was
Well, not to have older children, I guess maybe younger children, right?
Younger, and now it's younger children.
Yeah.
But I did go through the whole file, and initially, the distance between the fence and the abutter's property line was 15 feet. I have also gone by the property about 7 times to see if children were outside. I never saw any children, though.
I know that in other lots in the neighborhood, anybody can put up a fence on their property. So I'm not sure if the fence is even tied to the conditional
The fence was
use.
Not, it was not tied to the original, I didn't see anything about the play area being within 5 feet. It was the paving that had to be
correct
10 feet from the property line.
So it was my understanding that Kim can put the fence where she would like to, and just out of courtesy is keeping it 5 feet away from the property line for buffering. But it's not tied to the conditional use. And anybody else in the neighborhood can go and put their fence up as well where they would like, as long as it meets the code requirements. And I believe this fence does. And if she expands it towards her house and not towards the road or setbacks, then it's, I think, a personal choice.
Is the yard setback 5 feet there?
No, there's no setback requirement for fences. And to answer Mr. Huebner's question, when you get an approval, you have to comply with your approval, and the approval was for a maximum of 12 children.
Mm-hmm.
But receiving approval for 12 children doesn't preclude you from coming back and asking for an amendment.
Okay. I guess that's what I was getting at. It wasn't set in. Okay.
It's actually very typical for any site plan to come back for various types of amendments.
Okay. All right.
Can you explain the wetland delineation map at the back of your packet? It seems to show wetlands, but otherwise the way that parking spaces and other things are delineated doesn't seem to match up with any of the other plans.
Correct. This was included in your packet that we received out of the file. It's Appendix A is what is the plan she's referring to. And that was only in there because it was clarifying the RP1 and the RP2 zone. We aren't really sure where this other diagram came from. I'm not anyways, with the round proposed paving. I do not believe that was part of the original conditional
use. So this is not your work?
No, this is attachment for your reference, and the reference is for the wetlands only in this particular plan.
But is it, I assume that since this was in your packet, you had delineated these wetlands, is that you had verified that this was a current setup here?
I think, Maureen, I don't know if you could answer that.
You had asked at the last meeting for the applicant to provide a copy of the original approved plan. That's the original plan approved in 1997. It wasn't prepared by Rachel or by the current applicants, but that was approved by the planning board.
As opposed to the site plan standard boundary survey, that's what I thought the first thing in the packet. I'm getting confused, because the first thing in the packet and the last thing in the packet, both of which I think are being described as the original plan, show some different building and parking configurations.
I don't think Appendix A was designed as the original plan, Maureen. Is that right?
Apparently, the origin of Appendix A is a little foggy. Appendix A was submitted, I believe, as part of the building permit for the Bowdler lot, because when the daycare was originally approved, there was just a straight line along. If you look on the left-hand side of the plan, you'll see there's a stream, and there's an RP wetland boundary there as well. And then as you proceed north on the property, the wetlands head to the right.
Right, correct.
And if they were RP1 wetlands, it would make that lot that's to the north an unbuildable lot.
Right.
So what happened was, and I don't know the specifics of this because it never came to the planning board, but somehow this plan got revised by the people asking for the building permit on the Bowdler lot so that they could show that the RP1 boundary went straight up along the stream, and the RP2 boundary is the one that jogged out into that lot. But I can't tell you exactly where this came from. I can tell you that when these applicants came back, since this was acceptable to the code enforcement officer for the lot to the north, it seemed it should be acceptable wetlands mapping for the current daycare. And I think that's why it was included?
That's correct. That's why it was included.
Okay. Thank you.
Other questions? Okay, well, I've been by a number of times and have, as I say, I've tried to find children, and I've gone at different times, and children were never outside when I went. I went at the wrong times. But I was able to carefully observe. In fact, probably the neighbors next door saw somebody turning around the same car in their lot 3 or 4 times. That line of vegetation. Now, I know what you're saying about the fence. However, this is being used as a non-residential lot. And I'm having some trouble moving the fence closer to the property line in this case, especially without putting in. There is vegetation there, but there's also a huge hole there in the middle of the vegetation. And the fence isn't that high. The fence is only about, I'd say, 3.5 feet high, maybe 4 feet high. No, I think. I could be wrong, but I think. So the buffer isn't that great. And moving it closer to the building is not a problem, to your property line. But for me, moving it back towards the neighbor's property line is a problem. I don't know how anybody else feels about that. I don't know who else has gone by the property except for me.
I've never thought this out. I can't say.
I'd actually like to do a sidewalk.
I'm with you, really. We've had a fair amount of reaction to this proposal. And we've gotten a number of emails, and we've gotten somebody sent around, I think the Boulders sent around a form letter for everybody to sign. And sort of neighbors have gotten a little bit concerned. And when I read the original file, there was concern then, too. And I think I would agree with you that we should sidewalk and judge for ourselves. How do the rest of you feel, though?
I'm not opposed to that.
Okay.
I'm trying to figure out where we are procedurally. I mean, we opened the public hearing the last time. Is that right, Mark?
Yes.
And then we continued.
No, you closed it.
Oh, we did.
Closed the public hearing. We've just gotten a lot more emails.
I understand. I'm just trying to see where we're at.
So we'd have to have a site walk and then
bring it back for hearing.
Bring it back. Well, I don't know that we have to bring it back for another hearing.
We have to bring it back to a regular meeting.
Right,
we have to bring it back to a regular meeting and make a decision. And I think the reason for the site walk is, number one, to see the fence and see how we feel about moving it further. And also to judge whether or not, you know, 20 is too many, or is okay, or is this the appropriate place for that many children? I don't know.
You mentioned not seeing any children out there the times that you drove by, and I think when one of the letters, not one of the letters, the owner said their kids are out twice a day, once for an hour in the morning and once for an hour in the afternoon?
I went between 3 and 5 twice, and I didn't see any children. And it was a beautiful day. It just, I was there at the wrong time, that's all.
Okay.
Well, I pulled into the neighbor's, you know, driveway so I could see whether or not there were children there. Well, you know, they may have gone inside 3 minutes before I got there. There's no way to know that. I didn't hear anyone either. So, but how can we schedule so that we can go there perhaps and you know, quietly observe the children?
Because it seems to me that the physical changes to the property are minimal, even though the fence is proposed to be moved a little bit closer to the property line. It seems to me the real concern is the additional noise on the property, the additional traffic for the property. It's going to result from a change from 12 children to 20 children, which is a fairly significant jump. And I think in order to sort of get a sense of that, we need to have a feeling of the proximity of the neighbors and the setup of the land, and perhaps get a sense as to whether some more effective buffering might
absolutely
alleviate
I
that.
I think from my own standpoint, and this is just an opinion for me, I'm not concerned about the traffic at all. Because I do not see how eight cars dropping off their children is going to create any kind of a traffic problem. I'm glad the sign is being moved back. I think regardless of our decision, that's a good decision, and that, you know, a nicer sign is certainly would be in order there. But I am concerned that we make a decision that as best we can about the increase in the number of children. I think you're absolutely right. Anybody else have any opinion? So
no, the owner expects the increase in children to be infants. What does she base that on?
She bases that, and Kim can come up and speak, but she's basing that on her interest from siblings that she already has.
Okay.
Who have a second child, you know, mom's pregnant or has a little infant and would like to keep their children together, and she can't add any more children at this point. But, I mean, I've been through all that, and I wanted my children to stay together. So it just makes it easier for the family. So it almost doesn't increase the traffic either, because typically they are siblings.
Well, I don't think the traffic is, for myself, it's not any concern, because
right.
there's no way that eight additional children are going to generate 100,
right.
100 cars at a peak
right.
hour.
That's right.
And that's the only thing we have to be concerned with. But I don't think that you can say, I don't think we can think about it in terms of infants. Because we don't know how long they'll be infants. As children get older, then they're going to stay at the daycare center.
Could I comment on that?
Sure.
The reason you would have to say infants is because we can only have so many preschoolers, so many toddlers, and so many infants. It's required by law through Department of Human Services that we have to have 3 rooms being 4 infants, 5 toddlers, and up to 10 preschoolers. And that's it. We can't change that. That's where, you know, Department of Human Services come in.
We can submit that information to you.
But there would be nothing to change you from an infant's room to a toddler's room.
The higher demand is for infants right now.
No, I understand that, but 5 years from now, may not be.
And it's not for preschoolers right now. It's much more for infants.
I understand that, but we have to make a decision based on the raw number of 20, not on whether you're going to have infants or you're going to have 2-year-olds or 3-year-olds. We need to make a decision based on a number.
Right.
One other thing I wanted to add is the new plans you've produced have been really helpful, and I know there was a lot of expense to coming up with this, but I think at this point we're now in a position where we can evaluate what was approved, what's been done contrary to the approvals, and what's being proposed. So I really appreciate the extra work that you've put in to making these plans available.
Thank you. And I guess just one other question that I have is that do you find that I am following all the ordinances? Did you take note of that? Because I just don't understand why I cannot get approval tonight and maybe pending on your site walk to make any of those decisions about adding landscape or whatsoever, because that's fine. I'd be willing to do that, but could I get approval pending the site walk based on the fact that I'm following all the ordinances?
If we feel we have to have a site walk, we have to do that first.
Well, and I think what she's looking for would be a conditional approval and
Right.
pre a site walk. That's not something I don't think we've ever done.
No, we can't.
I mean, the conditions that we usually leave open on a conditional approval would be sort of ministerial, changing the plan, submitting them, not substantive changes to the plan. But I don't see any reason, if we can get the site walk in between now and the next meeting, that this wouldn't come to a vote the next meeting. Is that...
No, we're going to schedule it right now.
Right. And it's going to be before the next meeting.
Yes. Now, how can we schedule it? Because some of people work to do this.
I'm not as keen, I guess, on sort of doing it around the kids' schedule there, maybe.
You're not? Okay.
I just think that's going to be too hard and somewhat artificial. I mean, so they know we're going to be coming, so... I mean,
I'll make myself available.
Yeah.
I want to commend the applicant. I think you did a great job in your plans. I know it hasn't been the easiest of roads, so I want to commend you for that. But I will make myself available.
Okay. I'll defer to the people who are working to set this up.
What time would it be that you would have children?
We are usually always out by 9:30, 10 o'clock. And then we go in about 11 for lunch. Then they take their naps, and then we're out again by 3 after nap and after snack. And we're usually out from 3 to 4. And any nice day, we are definitely out there. You may not see us because they're short. We sit down on the ground with them. And you may not hear them too much because they're not very noisy. And I would say they probably were out there when you were sitting there, because we've been out every day. When this lovely weather is from 3 to 4, 3 to 4:30, we're out there.
Do we really think a sidewalk's really going to change our minds, really? You know, if they're out for recess twice a day for an hour, and the number of kids that are going to be out for recess really aren't going to change from what they are now.
A lot of times kids are taking naps. We never have all of them out at the same time. Right now you're only going to see 6 or 8 out at a time. And then if this was approved, again, you still won't see 20 kids out at any one time. They all, you know, infants and toddlers nap at all different times of the day. The preschoolers definitely get out from 9 to 10 and 3 to 4. Other than that, we do preschool work, I mean, 10, well, more 10 to 11. So we do preschool class from 9 to 10, and then 10 to 11 we go out for playtime. We have it all scheduled. We have a full schedule.
I think as a board, are we going to try to get out there when the kids are there or not? I personally don't think that makes a difference.
I mean,
we're looking at the fence line. We're looking at buffering. Whether the kids are there doesn't matter to me, number one. Number
right.
two, I do think we should maybe discuss what Jim brought up, which is, you know, what difference is that going to make? And maybe it will make a difference in terms of where the fence is going to land or a request by the board for some additional buffering. So I think that's the reason maybe to go out there. But I don't see any value in trying to coordinate it around whether the kids are out, which means we're either picking before work or after work or on a weekend.
Well, I have another thing to throw out. I'm not sure we can do this because I'm not sure it doesn't hamstring somebody. Is there a way to give approval for this and require that a certain number of the children be infants, which is up to 18 months or something?
No, I think it's set by the state, what she said, right?
No, I know, but if we have that as part of the approval, but you may run into a problem later on and not be able to take a child who's a sibling because they're too old, or not be allowed to have another child in the daycare center because they're too old too.
Well, that's okay, because I'm going to follow the state guideline and I'm going to do an infant room, a toddler room, and a preschool room, and that's definite. So
I mean, that's another way to do this, and then I can tell you there is a gap in the landscaping, and personally I'd like to see a couple of trees in there, and I do have a concern with moving that fence closer to that property line. I don't care whether you go to your wall. That makes no difference at all, because that's your property,
that's
and that's
fine.
But that's a condition we could put on it, and then that might be the middle ground between the neighbors who are concerned about more noise and things, because these infants aren't ever going to be outside.
So do I hear the applicant right? She's willing to do those two changes?
I am willing to do those.
I mean, if that's sort of the maximum of where we're going, what are we going to look at? I'm trying to just find...
No, I agree, and we're trying to expedite this, and if...
I'm not doing it for that reason. I'm saying I want to go out for a purpose. I don't want to go out there to move a fence that they've already agreed to move, and to go out there to add some landscaping buffering that they're willing to do. Then what's the issue?
I guess the description of the operation that we're hearing from the applicant, and the description of the operation and the impact on the neighborhood that we heard from people who appeared in the public hearing, is very different. And for me personally, I feel that I owe it to the neighborhood to go out and take my own look, and for us to do that as a board, because we're hearing very different things here. And the other thing is, I'm concerned about us as a planning board getting in the business of monitoring how many children of what age happen to be at a daycare center. That's really not our business. That's the business of the state of Maine, because they regulate that for safety of care reasons. That's not our business. So I don't want to be putting conditions on there that's really beyond our competence to monitor or to enforce. So I would, you know, rather say we need more buffering or we don't need more buffering, but I think we need to evaluate that ourselves because we're hearing very different things.
But what I'm hearing is the applicant's willing to do those things already. Yeah. So if we go out there and say, oh, we need more buffering, you're saying you're more than willing to do that.
I'll cover that one area.
We don't see a plan for that buffering, and I guess I would want to see that and let people who came to the meeting see what that plan is and react to it, unless we can come up with it right here.
That sounds like an unnecessary expense on their part.
I think we could actually come up with it
right
here.
That's not an unusual condition of approval. That's something we would normally say, okay, we approve it subject to a submission of a plan that shows buffering in whatever way we discuss. I mean, I'm not sure what would help here in terms of that, so I'm looking to...
I'd like to make sure that what we're talking about is delineated appropriately. So the conditions to approval that you'd be willing to agree to would be to limit the number of children to a total of how many?
Well, I'm actually going to limit it to 19, although the license is 20, and that's just because Department of Human Services has their standards of, you know, 20 children, then the next limit. So I'm actually going to have 19.
Okay, but there's a very large difference between offering something, if you will, and then regulating it. Okay, so what you're saying is you're willing to condition our approval upon a maximum number of children at all times at 19.
Right.
And then toddlers, infants, and others. So if you could delineate that as well, so that we're sure about what we're voting on. And
right.
It does make a difference.
Right. And it's definitely going to be that.
Okay,
you know,
so give me the numbers, please.
But are we making that part of the conditional approval?
Well, I want to ask that as a question in a second.
Okay, fair enough.
I want to make sure that I understand the facts first.
All right, four infants in the infant room, five toddlers in the toddler room, and up to 10 preschoolers in the preschool room.
And what's the number of preschool children that you currently have?
Currently, we have, I'm going to say, six.
So you're talking about a net increase of four preschool children.
Correct.
Okay, and are the toddlers also outside?
The toddlers go out.
And what's the total net increase of toddlers?
None. We probably have the five now.
Okay.
Or more, actually.
So I have to say publicly that I respectfully disagree. I think that it is the purview of this planning board to condition our approval on the number of children, and specifically what areas those children will be utilizing. To the extent that that impacts the neighborhood with respect to outside noise, I do think it's part
right.
of the purview
because
of this plan.
Because the four infants will probably not be outdoors much at all.
Okay.
So that does take away some of the noise concern.
But how would you enforce that?
Okay. I think that's a code enforcement issue. To the extent that there are children outside and there is a complaint with respect to noise, that clearly you would have the ability as a code enforcement officer to see how many children are utilizing the play area.
But does a code enforcement officer, I guess...
It's a usage issue.
Wouldn't the state...
The state has the ability to regulate and enforce the state regulations. The code enforcement officer would have the ability to regulate and enforce the approval that this planning board makes.
Well, you know, we put conditions on, for example, Inn by the Sea. They have to regulate the decibels of noise. We have said you cannot have more than X decibels of noise on the property line.
How many children do you have outside at one time?
Right now, probably, well, there are times where we have them all out at one time. We could have up to 12, but for the most part, usually seven or eight, usually toddlers are sleeping or infants are sleeping during outdoor time.
So we could regulate the number of children outside?
Yeah, we could definitely do that.
As opposed to the number of children enrolled. My problem, Tom, is not the number of children inside or outside, we can talk about that. The number of children enrolled and the age composition of the enrollees in the school, I think, is not appropriate for us to make a determination. I would feel comfortable saying, if you say now there are eight students outside at one time, that we could give an approval that says no more than 8 or 10 children would be outside in the playyard at any one time. It's a very easy thing for the neighbors to see, it's a very easy thing for us to regulate, and to me, that's very much within our parameters, but not the question of the enrollment.
I think that would work well, because, as I said, the preschool room will have 10. So if we could make that number 10, because that teacher would have to bring all her students out, she couldn't leave two behind, then, of course, when others go out, it'll be only 5, or maybe a couple of babies on a swing.
So how many preschool and how many toddlers would you expect to have at future?
10 preschoolers, 5 toddlers.
So you may potentially have to tell a few kids, I'm sorry, you can't go outside now, we can only have a few, I'm just trying to think of the actual operation.
They're going to be in separate rooms with separate teachers. So if the preschool teacher was to take out her class of 10 for 30 minutes, then bring them in, then the toddler teacher could bring out her class of 5 for 30 minutes and bring them in.
Is that practical?
Yes, that would be totally practical.
Because I don't want to get in the minutiae of your operation.
It's practical because the toddlers and the preschoolers are pretty much on different schedules, nap-wise, eating-wise. They're not always on the same schedule, so that is definitely something that would be feasible for us to do.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is that the applicant is willing to condition the approval upon no greater than 10 children being permitted in the play area at any one time.
Correct.
Okay. In addition, I heard moving a fence. To the extent it's not currently shown on this plan?
No, it is shown.
It is.
It's this right here.
Okay, but I thought I had just heard Barbara say
that. It is. If you look at the original, where it is now, they're talking about moving it closer to the neighbor's property line.
Yeah. Okay.
And I'm saying that I don't think that's a good idea because I've been there and seen it.
Right. But what I had thought I heard, and correct me please, is that you were willing to keep the fence on the existing fence line, and rather than moving it back toward the neighbor line, perhaps closer toward Patricia Drive. Did I misunderstand that?
No, Patricia Drive, no. But in the parking lot.
Toward the parking
lot.
So effectively, the line of the fence that abuts the back neighbor, I believe that's the Ballers lot, I'm not sure whose it is, but
it is.
You'd be willing to keep that where it is. So
yeah.
You would amend the existing. Okay, so that's the second change that I've heard tonight.
Yep.
Condition, if you will. And then the third is with respect to buffering, landscaping. And what's the applicant proposing for that?
This is the space that has some opening, and we could just continue with the same bushes and bring them right along here.
As I currently see it, that is on the abutter's lot.
Right.
So you're saying you'd be willing to put it on your lot?
Correct.
But continue the visible line?
Yes.
Okay. So those are the three changes that I have heard. Now, my question to the board is, given those three changes, is there a need for a site visit?
I don't think so.
I don't think so either.
The additional buffering, can you just describe it again, since I'm trying to draft as we talk here?
Great.
Let's see. I can't figure out how many trees. It's about a...
Does it show on your photograph?
It's about a five... Isn't it about a 5 or 6 foot gap in there?
Can we go over there and look at
the photograph? Yeah, it's about...
Sure, go right ahead.
I have one more question for the architects. One of the things I'm trying to determine here.
Don't get ahead of us yet.
Okay.
Can you hold that, because I want to get this condition down.
Okay.
Before we move on.
Jim, could you just move it for everybody?
And pardon me, what's the linear footage of that gap approximately?
You scale it off.
It's approximately 10 feet.
And how many trees do you think you would need in order for that, as mature trees, to complete that line?
If we go with the tulia, probably two.
What kind of trees are there now?
Tulia, probably. It's a tulia arborvitae. But they come in different varieties, so they will mature growth will be anywhere from a 4-foot diameter to like a 12-foot, so depending on what the variety is that's there or similar. So if you have about a 10-foot gap, you would need 2 to 3 of these.
So Peter, for drafting purposes.
And are they reasonably priced, so
yes,
we're not
they are.
Asking the applicant to spend a fortune on three trees.
Right, I would recommend 4 to 6 foot tree.
Okay. I would be more comfortable with 6 feet because that's a little bit higher, but I don't know the price of these things either.
Can I ask you a question? I'm still trying to go back to the deviations from the approved site plan. Because although I acknowledge that the changes to what's existing back on the ground are very minimal, I think it's important for us not to accept simply as an approved fact some variations from what we've approved. So what I'm trying to figure out, I'm looking at the fenced play area on
which,
the approved.
Which plan are you looking at? 103?
I'm looking at the what I understand was the approved site plan, which is the first thing we have.
I think the fencing is the same as that's on there now.
I don't think it's that's what I'm trying to figure out, because it shows the dimension of the approved fencing as 40 feet by 45 feet, the back property line and along Patricia Drive. Correct? On the approved site plan.
40 and 50. You mind?
Okay.
This is the one called Site Plan Standard Boundary Survey. It shows the back fence dimension is 40 and the side along Patricia Drive is 45.
Meaning the May 26, 1997 plan?
Yes, which I understand is the original approval. The proposed, the existing fence is not dimensioned on the right-hand side that I can see. What I'm trying to see is how much bigger is the existing fence than what has been approved?
Does it look that much different? Maybe a little bit bigger, but it looks like the property line actually came in closer, giving it.
It did, but that's why I'm trying to, it's difficult to judge that, and I assume that they have measurements, so it would be helpful to know those measurements.
That's 40 by.
And you're requesting that just for the record, I guess. You're not.
Well, no, because I think it's important. We have an existing violation of a site plan, and we're approving a modification of that site plan. So I think it's important to know what the existing violation is and be very clear on that when we're essentially approving it, and it's now the status quo, but it's not in conformity with the site plan. I think it's important for us to.
As I understand what we're doing, and I'm. Is if we do approve a plan, it's got to land at that plan, regardless of
the past
violation.
That's right. And that will become approved, and then it will no longer be a violation.
Right.
But I think it's important for us to know what it is that we're approving, so that we not set a precedent where if somebody comes in out of conformity with a site plan, that we just say, oh, okay.
I could just make a comment. You have a full-scale drawing in your packet,
right?
And that is to scale, so you could actually measure it off.
L102?
But you don't have that.
I don't have it on top of my head, and I don't have it in front of me, but if I had a scale, I'd tell you what it was. So that one's accurate.
I got a scale. What's the.
20 feet to an inch, is that right?
Yeah, one needs to go.
You know, I think one of the problems that happened here is that the fence may never have moved from the original approval. You know, what moved was the property line.
Yes, that's correct.
I want to stay focused.
And
it scales at 45 feet.
Scales at.
On the side?
The existing.
The eastern.
This one right here is 2 1/4 inches.
fence, 45.
So at 1 to 20.
So that'd be 45 feet.
That's 45.
So I don't think the fencing has ever changed. It's not the violation. What changed was that property line, which made it that much closer to the abutter. But on the new plan, you want to move that fence out by how many feet?
I actually think they made their area smaller.
They're not moving.
About that north fence is.
They weren't going to move the fence out at all?
It's going west.
It's only going back towards the house.
Correct.
And what I'm saying is in error, too, because I am saying that I didn't want you to move the fence any closer to the property line, but you're not proposing to move the fence any closer to the property line.
No.
No, we're just going to extend it.
You're extending it to the west?
Correct.
Well, I don't have any problem with extending it to the west.
But as shown on the plan, we have L102, correct?
This is existing.
Existing and proposed.
So they are moving it closer to the property?
Yes.
My understanding from looking at it was that you wanted to move it closer to the abutter's property.
No, it's just this evening, like you said, the property line jogged. So if you look at the original plan, it just shows the property line going straight across. So it looks like...
No, I understand the property line changed during the time this was a daycare center. And what we were looking at from Plan A to Plan B was the change in the property line, not the change in the fence. The fence never moved. Is that correct? It looks like an original fence there to me. Doesn't look like a new fence.
It's just maybe 4 or 5.
I think...
Well, we were going to do a straighten it to, so it wasn't going to be like 4 or 5 feet, because it's kind of coming inward at an angle. So we were just going to straighten it from the start to there, but we don't...
We're not going to do that.
So essentially, by straightening it, you were going to move it closer to the neighbor's property. So that's what I'm objecting to.
Right, and we won't do that.
That's what we're saying, we won't, we're taking back that and just going west.
Right.
Oh, okay.
So how will that be on our plan then, so we know?
In other words...
How far will you then be from the property line?
It actually comes farther from the property line.
Right.
Okay, so we're just going to leave it straight the way it is now, so maybe you're going to be 8 feet from the property line, or 7 feet from the property line on our right-hand side.
Yeah, it's not straight across on the property line.
All right. So I guess we have to say it, Peter, that the fence, the northern side of the fence stays in the same, exactly as it is today.
Correct.
Except that it can move to the west.
Move to the west. Continue the current line of the fence, extending it to the west.
Yes.
The only other issue that I see remaining, at least from my consideration, is with respect to the proposed new sign. Have you addressed that yet? Apologies for my delay in getting here.
Yeah, they're moving it backwards, so it's out of the right-of-way.
And will it have any increase in dimension, the sign itself?
Slightly, by a few inches in either direction, I believe. But it's under, according to the sign ordinance, it's way under the...
It meets the sign ordinance.
The sign ordinance. Okay. It's below it.
Thank you.
The required amount.
And moving it back is going to take it out of visibility. It's going to make it in a much better place. Is there anything else anybody has? The name of those...
Is Peter going to generate the motion?
Please, Peter.
I'm going to get overtime with this. Just, you got to give me a minute, because I'm trying to get the fence line issue correct. Where does the additional buffering going exactly?
It's a 10-foot linear space from the existing
arborvitae
or similar tree to be
jogging the property line.
To be filled in with no greater than 4 6-foot tall arborvitae or similar trees.
Four or
six.
No greater than 4 6-foot tall.
Oh, four. Okay.
Arborvitae or similar trees. And I think you should include in there, Peter, a maintenance responsibility, not only for planting, but to maintain them.
But the purpose is that the hedge is completely to create a solid hedge. I think that's the key, more than the number of trees, that it's got to be a solid hedge.
All right, so the three conditions I have is no more than 10 students outside in the play area at any time. Two, the fence along the north side be extended along its current line only to the west and not closer to the abutters property.
And that the number be changed to 19?
I have that already.
Okay, good.
I'm not finished, but then that additional buffering be installed on the north side of the fence, is that correct?
Yeah, landscape buffering installed.
I didn't hear you talk.
Landscape buffering be installed along the north, along the north side of the property.
Be installed.
To create a solid hedge between the existing tree, approximately 10 feet in linear feet.
That additional landscape buffering be installed as a solid hedge on the north side of the fence, approximately 10 feet linear?
10 linear feet, correct, yeah.
Using no greater than 4 6-foot arborvitae or similar tree, the applicant shall maintain these trees as part of the approval.
Well drafted.
Okay. All right.
Is that a motion?
Oh, I know.
Peter?
Well, let me pull it all together in one. Do we need a plan, Maureen, to reflect any of this?
Yeah, there should be a condition that says the plan be revised to pick the above.
That a plan be submitted reflecting the above changes to the planning requirement. Is that okay?
The goal is to be
cooperative. All right, is there anything else we want to discuss?
Anything else, anybody?
Can't be on there.
Okay. All right. No, we have a motion for the board to consider.
Madam Chair, I have the motion for the board to consider. I move that we make the following findings of fact. Kim Newman of Comfy Cape Daycare, located 111 Scott Dyer Road, is requesting an amendment to the previously approved site plan to expand the daycare from 12 to 19 children, which requires review under Section 19-9 site plan regulations. Two, the application substantially complies with Section 19-9 site plan regulations and Section 19-8-8C daycare facility standards. Therefore, I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Kim Newman of Comfy Cape Daycare, located at 111 Scott Dyer Road, to expand the daycare from 12 to 19 children be approved, subject to the following four conditions. One, that no more than 10 students are outside in the play area at any time. Two, that the fence along the north side be extended along its current line only to the west and not closer to the abutters property. Three, that additional landscape buffering be installed as a solid hedge along the north side of the fence, approximately 10 linear feet, using no greater than 4 6-foot arborvitae or similar tree. The applicant shall maintain these trees as part of this approval, and that a plan be submitted reflecting the above changes to the planning department.
A friendly amendment, that the square footage with respect to the play area for the extension of the fence be no greater than 2,000 square feet in total.
Okay, so amending condition number two, that the fence along the north side be extended along its current line only to the west and not closer to the abutters property, so that the total square footage does not exceed 2,000 square feet.
I second the motion.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Thank you for working
you
so
much.
Hard on this project and for
Thank you very much.
Complying, and I hope the abutters will feel we've reached a compromise.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I think of all the points that happened here, because I think there's a few corrections that need to be made. And if you guys decided that without even discussing the fact that you're moving the property to the west actually gets closer to our house, it does not solve the problem of playground. Moving it north does move it towards our property line, and moving the playground west of our home. We built the house further back, the missed playground. Now, so we have a long driveway in order to miss the playground. We're right under the nose of the road development.
So that brings the noise closer to the home from the playground.
The only thing I could suggest that you do, we've approved the project, is it's about, it's like about 15 or 20 feet, is go to the applicant and talk to them about it.
That's see.
Well, they're gone and there's nothing we can do at this point.
Why didn't you have a chance to speak?
Because this is not a public hearing.
We didn't get a chance to explain our side of the story. We had a legitimate complaint, and many of the neighbors did over noise. And noise.
I'm sorry, but there's at this point there's. Does anybody have any suggestions about what to do? Because the applicant is gone. We've approved the project, and
well, we knew that there was neighbors here that had problems with us. Why weren't we allowed to speak?
Okay, I'm really sorry, but we're going to have to move on.
That seems pretty unfair. I'm a bit disappointed in the way that was handled.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Just a little note for next time.
I'm sorry.
There's a lot of people here very disappointed in the expansion of that lake.
Okay, next project. Can we go on to the next project? Go ahead. Yeah, in by the sea.
Good evening.
May I ask a question? Excuse me.
Yes.
Just how has that historically been handled by this board? To the extent that there may have been a material fact for some residents, is there an appeal situation, or how does that occur?
Just a minute.
I'd just like to know for clarity's sake.
No, they can stay or leave. We were having our discussion.
Well, they can listen, though.
As a new planning board member, I'm curious with respect to
this. I understand that Maureen can correct me if I'm wrong. There is a procedure for a reconsideration of a vote.
Mm-hmm.
It has to be made by somebody on the prevailing side, which in this case was 5-0, which means any one of us can make the motion. And it has to be done, I believe, within 30 days of the meeting. Maureen, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. That's the procedure. So that's been done in the past. I'm not saying what should be done or shouldn't be done, but if somebody presents that, one of us presents that, the board can consider it as a motion.
And Maureen, if there's an aggrieved abutter and we have changed a condition to a site plan, there is no requirement for a second public hearing, correct?
No. And in fact, the applicant is required to submit their plans 18 days prior to the meeting.
Mm-hmm.
We have a copy of those plans on file in the town office. Anyone in the public can come to the office to review those plans. In fact, the abutter did come and review those plans. Any abutter, while you are not holding an official public hearing, you're always receiving written correspondence.
And we did.
In fact, you received written correspondence from the abutter for tonight's meeting.
The other avenue, and I'm not encouraging this, there is a court appeal to all of this.
Understood.
But the other thing we can say about this, too, is that the landscape buffer is there on the west side.
I'm not questioning the facts with respect to the decision. I just wanted to know what the appeal process, if there was one, within. Thank you.
I'm sorry, but we're going to need to move on. We've got a real long meeting here.
I appreciate that, but as a citizen, I want to understand the due process without your signing like that at me, because I want to understand.
Yes, please. Go ahead.
The problem for everyone in this audience is this is a public meeting.
Yes.
And we are required to keep a written record of everything that happens at this meeting. And anyone who's sitting out in the audience that's calling out comments is not getting into our recording equipment. And this lady over here who's furiously trying to write is not able to get your name, not able to get your address, and not able to have any kind of backup as to what is said. So the only time we can take public comment is when you put it in writing or if you're standing at the podium where we can pick up what you're saying. In addition, this meeting is being televised. And anyone who's at home watching this right now, all they're hearing is in the background.
The technology too.
Well, I know, it is the state's right to know law that regulates this. It isn't a whim of this particular board or this particular town. We are required to keep these records, and we're required to provide notices of the meeting, and we're required to send out.
I'd love to ask the question into the microphone. I just want to understand.
And I guess what you need to understand is the planning board has rules of procedure. And those rules of procedure say that members of the public are only allowed to address the planning board when there is a scheduled public hearing.
Great, that's what I want.
Other than that, you can write a letter anytime.
That's what I wanted to understand. And so this conversation was not a public hearing.
This was like way, way beyond the rules of procedure.
Okay, Steve, go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Steve Brass here with Oak Engineers, representing the In By The Sea LLC. At the April Planning Board meeting, we had received an approval, but with a condition that I reappear in May at this meeting, and also in regards to the location, orientation, I should say, of the mechanical building. We were before the board September 18th, 2007, and from what I believe was in Marino Mera's letter, received approval at that time for a rotation of the building. The plans that I have behind me are the actual plans that we had that night but may not have had up on this board at that time, from what I understand.
There were no plans up on the board, because I actually went, but I did check the video of the meeting.
Yes.
And there were no plans up on the board.
Okay. These were the plans that we did have, but they were in a 8.5 by 11 or 11 by 17 format. The actual coloring was done by Richard Lowe at TFH Architects, and if you recall from that meeting, we also had a couple other issues, but it did show the rotation of the building, which is in a north-south direction, and it also included this plan, which is the architectural plan that showed the elevations of the mechanical building, and pinned in here, which was on the original plans at that time, this shows from BBR, Bowery Beach Road. This is what you would be seeing, which is the louvered end of the building that shields the condenser unit that everyone might have seen 4 weeks ago. That is the actual elevation that was approved during the September 7th, 18th meeting. That is the elevation showing the louvered end. That is the north end elevation looking from the road in this direction, which shows the rotation of the building 90 degrees from what was approved in July of 2007. So based on what we feel was approved at that meeting, what I believe was in the meeting minutes of that meeting, and I believe was confirmed by Maureen in her letter of April 30th, 2008. Though no plans were actually on display there, we did have a package that had 8.5 by 11 or 11 by 17s that had these colored up. These were just exploded versions of that. That's why they're sort of distorted and discolored, because that's what I did, was I just took the plans that we had at that time, at that night, for approval. So I'm back before you showing or indicating that this is what we were here for in September, and what we believe we got approval for, and what I believe that the planning staff agrees that we have approval, or hopes that we have approval on. That's why I was back here before you.
Does anybody have any questions?
No.
We have a motion for the board to consider.
I move that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the planning board approves the placement of the mechanical building located at the Inn by the Sea, located at 40 Bowery Beach Road, as depicted on the most recently submitted plans.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay, Eastman Meadows.
Good evening. I guess the first thing I wanted to... my name is Owens McCullough, civil engineer with Sebago Technics, here tonight on behalf of Wiley Enterprises, LLC. Maybe there was some miscommunication on our part. We were prepared to do a PowerPoint presentation, and... I got really nervous when I didn't see it up here. Because all my graphics are in electronic form.
why don't we start with, you know, any other changes and questions?
Well, it's all really on the graphics.
We'd rather have them do it top to bottom.
You want to just go through the PowerPoint presentation?
Take five.
It's really sort of all...
That's fine.
Sorry about that.
That's fine. May I just make one little comment? And I talked to Maureen about it, and I tried to get her earlier today so she could get a hold of you, but I found something that I think is a slight miscalculation.
Okay.
And I think it was just somebody just missed it. In your calculations of net usable area on the second page, 2 of 18, regarding open space, start with 13, in the area 2, 13.1 acres of the total area, less ledge outcroppings of 0.2 acres, okay, less RP1 wetlands of 0.63. I think you missed the 0.2 when you subtracted.
You're looking at drawing sheet 2, is that what you're looking at?
Sheet 2 of 18 under...
Say it again, Barbara.
It's 2 of 18 under provided open space. It doesn't make any difference.
Nope, but I do want to correct it.
In terms of what you're proposing, it's simply that it's was just missed. And it's,
nope, I appreciate that. We still meet our minimum.
No, you do, but I mean in terms of having...
I would rather
numbers that are correct and, you know, everything dotted and crossed. I know you like to do that.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Sorry about that.
I mean, I may be wrong. You can look at it again, but I think
that's what happened. Nope, I ran the numbers through my head and yes, you are correct. Thank you.
So, are we going to be looking over here?
Yes, you will be.
I'm going to move again.
I should have called you. I didn't even think of that.
No, I didn't. I can't hear you.
Okay.
Kind of
here. Take a total. You come up with this. It's 12.27. It doesn't make any difference.
But it's not accurate.
It's not accurate.
Thank you for doing that.
It's all I love.
is on my email. We're going to put together a list of cell phone numbers, so I sent Peter an email saying I was going to be late tonight, so this way we can get through the people on their cell phones. Which makes good sense. Any pen?
Oh, I think she had that.
No, I don't think so.
Warm it up.
Yeah. We'll get there.
Yeah, it just didn't read the pen drive, so we think we had to restart it to recognize it as a need.
Does anybody want to ask any questions?
The only thing I would like you to address is changes from what we've previously heard, specifically referencing those items that we raised as potential issues.
Okay.
The letter from Wilbur Smith about the right of way.
No, Barbara, I just didn't make a copy of it, but you had asked, so I can read it in the record.
Oh, okay. Right. Everybody should read it. It's a letter about the right of way.
Site distances.
Yes. And not the site right of way, the site distances, sorry. I had asked for that. Maureen, are we close?
We're close.
Owens, can you do this without this? No? I mean, I've seen these, this happen so many times over with these PowerPoints that I realize you can't show Eastman Road and the, which would have been really helpful.
You had asked me to do was to take a look at Eastman Road for that gravel strip.
Right, I did.
And so we took, we went out, we actually walked the road and took a number of photographs and did some graphics to show how that would all come together. That's all.
And which would be really helpful to see. I did drive the road a couple of times and to see those trees and how big they were.
Yeah.
And where they were,
right.
And realize the problem. You actually tear up the road to put in the sewer line then,
yes.
And then repave.
That's correct. And then the shoulder...
They're going to repave the whole road, maybe?
...on the easterly side. I had some pictures of some of the rock outcrops and larger trees and the stone walls and stuff.
Let me ask a question. If you tear up part of the road, who do you just repave that part, or do you repave the whole top part of the road?
When we met with Bob Malley...
Uh-huh.
Not registering it?
Okay.
Oh, good. Okay. When we met with Bob Malley, we're going to most likely end up repaving half the street. So they'll come through with the sewer, and what will happen is a half to quarter of the street, depending on where that force main lies and how much of the street they disturb, but it'll be a uniform saw cut, and then they'll repave that section.
Wonder how we can encourage the town to repave the whole road.
There we go. Thank you for bearing with me. Sorry about that. There. Sorry about that. Again, I'll just start over. Again, my name is Owens McCullough, civil engineer with Sebago Technics, here tonight on behalf of Wiley Enterprises. With me is Joel Fitzpatrick from Wiley Enterprises, in case the board has any questions of Joel. When we were last before the board, we had reviewed a supplemental submittal. There was a lot of questions that came back from the board, which we've tried to address in this submittal. And one thing that came clear to us was that there had been a little bit of time that had lapsed from when we were last before the board. There were some new members, Elaine and Tom, that came to the board, and Scott Collins asked us to go back through the entire application. And we thought that it would be good to assemble not only the additional information the board asked for, but really packaged the whole submittal back together. So that's why your booklet was pretty involved, because for continuity we thought it might be nice to do that. And I wanted to take just a very few minutes to maybe go back in time just real quick and talk a little bit about why where we're at with this condominium project, why Joel saw this as the type of project to pursue for this property. And very fittingly, this past week, I attended the annual Spring Merida Conference here in Portland, which is a fairly large conference, and the title, it was at the USM Abramson Center, and the title was appropriately The Grain of Maine. And it spoke a lot about the demographics of Maine, the aging populations, the types of diversity of housing that we're going to be facing. And I wanted to just run through a couple of things, because it's very fitting to why we believe this type of project is the direction we need to go in. And a lot of these graphics are information that came right from the Merida conference. And it's kind of interesting. They talk about the baby boomers, which I guess I'm also part of that. I'm on the lower end, but
It ranges all the way up through 45 to 65, I guess. And, you know, they talked about that, you know, as the baby boomers were, you know, going through their maturing, you know, in 1980s, they talked about couples and what they built was starter homes, moving to larger homes and raising kids. And what was interesting is they're all projecting that now a lot of these baby boomers, which is quite a bubble of them, are reaching that point where kids are off to school. Some of them are still have professional careers, but they're moving to be empty nesters. And the interest seems to be focusing on condos for those folks. And this came from John. If all of you know who John Wasileski is at Seacoast Management, he spoke at the conference. And one thing he said, that as this population is aging, they, you know, today people like to be more active and healthy, it seems, you know. And in amenities, he said that, you know, what they're experiencing is people are looking for the basics. They're looking for a lot of complete maintenance-free living. And you know, a condominium of this project has an association. The people own inside the walls. The outside is all taken care of as part of the association. They pay into a fee through the association documents. And so essentially, those folks have a lot of freedoms. They don't have to be bound to this home to take care of the outside. It's done for them. And you know, then they like access, interesting enough, to conservation areas and trails. And this project is uniquely suited. It's right next to a very large open space area, and we are proposing to put about 65% of our land into open space and construct some trails. So, and golf, of course, and the Papudi Club is just down the street. And Maureen, you know, one of the things Maureen had looked at was she looked at the other condominiums in the Cape Elizabeth area, and I think it was like 11 school-age children out of 280-some condominiums. I've also worked for personally for doing condo projects for another Southern Maine developer, most recently down in Kennebunk on a very large project. And I think that when speaking to them, they had maybe two or three school-age children out of over 250 condominiums on their project. And Joel's project is specifically marketed and targeted towards this baby boomer group. And these were Frank O'Hara of planning decisions throughout some facts, which I thought was kind of interesting. Actually, it scared me a little bit because I'm moving into that age group. But he said 6,000 people per year are moving into the, this is in Maine, 65 to 75 age group. Half of them want a new home, like a condominium. Over 65 years old, 55% are now earning under $25,000 as they move into the retirement, hence the goal to try to keep things as affordable as possible. And then this was pretty scary. That group's going to increase by over 70% in the coming decades. And over 10,000 people turn 50 every day. And this was interesting, that about 460,000 people are between 43 and 66 in Maine. And what's interesting is in the town's comp plan, this is actually reflected in the town's comp plan, because if you look at the chart for this age group in Cape Elizabeth, that's your biggest demographic group in Cape Elizabeth, moving into that age range. And I think the town's comprehensive plan really identified this as an upcoming need. Goal one of your housing plan and the comprehensive plan identifies it as residents age and the need or desire to transition out of traditional single-family housing, their opportunities remain. The opportunities to remain in Cape Elizabeth are extremely limited. And Joel here, I know during the course of this project, has had a number of calls by folks, and I think somebody actually came to one of the meetings and spoke that this is something that they would be interested in. They'd like to sell their home and move into a condominium such as this. So we really feel strongly that the need is here and it's consistent with the comp plan. And then the land use goal plans out that, you know, that the town shall continue to promote clustering and propose new development identified in growth areas, increase open space, and discourage development in other parts of town. We're in the RB zone, which is a designated growth area, has mandatory open space. So it seems like, you know, everything, the direction we're going in with this project is really a good fit. And I just captured a couple of quick things from the RB zone, and it is a designated growth area. It does encourage open space. In fact, it's mandatory. And then it encourages public sewer and water, which we have, clustering, which we've put together, and as I indicated, it's about 65% of this property will be put into open space, which means only 35% will be developed. It promotes higher density developments and 10% mandatory affordable as part of the project, and this project will create 6 of those affordable units. And, you know, again, I just wanted to capture a couple of quick things. It was quite interesting from this Merida conference and also from what Joel has been studying in the area has been looking is, you know, we're hoping that the condominium project is going to meet a need. It's pretty clear that there's a need that is out there for this group as the baby boomers. It does offer some diversity of housing, and what I mean is it offers another option besides single-family houses in town, or apartments, or congregate care type facilities. So it provides sort of an intermediary housing. It's providing opportunities for Cape Elizabeth residents to stay in Cape, which we hope is a good thing. It's very consistent with the comp plan goals and the RV zone, and we think there's some public benefit to this. We're going to extend sewer down Eastman Road, which will then be available to other residents should they opt at some time to tie in. There's going to be a significant addition to open space. Some of that open space will be given directly to the town. Some of that open space will be dedicated with restrictions. We're going to construct some new trails, and we're going to connect those trails to the very large open space. We're going to add some affordable housing units. And, you know, one thing that does happen out of these is you have, it's a diversity housing, a different type of housing, and frankly, as indicated in the town impact, the study we did, you actually end up with a net increase in tax revenues because, frankly, we aren't putting kids into the school system. I have 3 kids, so I understand that, but it does just provide some diversity of housing and options in town. And, you know, this has been a long process that was started 2 years ago, Joel, is that correct? About 2 years ago when he looked at this, and he spent a lot of time meeting with the planning staff, public works director, different folks, just to evaluate that this is the right approach to go. We came to a workshop in February of 07, went back in September. There was a little bit of a lag because we went to the workshop, we presented our approach, got some positive feedback from the board, and then we put together the detailed plans. Came back in September of 07, had a couple of site walks in September and October of 07. Then there was a third site walk with some planning board members who wanted to review the entrances, the site distance that was out there, which was fine. And then we've had a peer review of that also by the town's peer review engineer from Wilbur Smith. Then we had an October 16th public hearing on the project. Then we actually returned back to the board in 07 with some modifications to it because of some supplemental wetland mapping and working with the DEP and those folks. We actually went to the Conservation Commission in January because we do have a wetland alteration as part of the project, and sought their endorsement of the project. Got very positive feedback from those folks, and then we came back to you folks in March of 08, which was the most recent meeting, and then back tonight. So I thought it was important to just walk through the history. This has been a project that's been in the works and been given a lot of thought on the design and the need of it. And so here's where we're at today. What you have in front of you is a graphic I think you've seen before. In the green is our project site. With the layout of the condominiums, the colorations next to it represent the various open spaces that abut the property, and in the dark green is what will also be dedicated as open space as part of our project. This is a little closer view of the layout, which is 46 condominiums on a 40.82 acre parcel. There's one existing farmhouse that right there. Right there is the existing farmhouse, and that will be preserved on a 15,000 square foot lot, and then the 47 condominiums would be in this area here, abutting the open space in this location, and then down to here. There will be a trail that we'll build from here down through, connecting into the large open space out back, and we're going to dedicate an easement along a sidewalk that runs through here,
and then also into the open space so that there are those trail connections within the property. At the last meeting, there were some items that was asked of us by the board, and I'll just run through them to go through those. One was Tom Errico from Wilbur Smith has since reviewed the site distance of the project entrances and has issued a memorandum, I think Maureen just passed around, indicating that we are consistent with the road classification table in town. The other thing that was brought up was that they wanted us to meet with the fire chief to review the hydrant flow information that had been done. As you might remember, there was some, originally we had submitted some hydrant flow data that was just about 10 years old, I guess. And we ended up having the Portland Water District last October do an actual flow test, which showed there was 1,085 gallons per minute of fire flow available. That flow meets the town requirements. The fire chief wanted at least 1,000 gallons per minute, so we did meet that, and it's referenced in the updated memorandum from Chief Gleason. The other thing in the memorandum from the chief, as we discussed at the last board meeting, we had proposed a road width of 20 feet through the development on the main roads, this one here, and this one here, which is Phoebe's Lane and Tanninger Lane. And the board asked about, the town's ordinance talks about 22 feet in width. We had proposed 20 for the project. After we went away from the board meeting, we met with the fire chief and other and the public works director within the town. Both felt that from a safety standpoint, from a fire access standpoint, that they wanted us to go to 22 feet in width, which we have complied with. The plan now shows 22 feet in road width, with the exception of these two short drives right here and right here. Those are 18 feet in width, and the fire chief is okay with that. We also have added some fire hydrants to the plan, meeting with the fire chief, and all of that has been worked through, and there's a memorandum regarding that. The public works director, I believe, also has issued an updated memorandum indicating that he finds the road design acceptable. Another thing that came up at the meeting was Eastman Road. And on Eastman Road, let's make sure I get to the right slide right here. Well, where'd they go? There we go. And it kicked me back to the beginning. Sorry about that. I'll get back to the buildings in a minute. The other thing that came up was on Eastman Road. As part of the project, there was some discussion about adding a pedestrian shoulder along Eastman Road to improve pedestrian movement along the road. We said we would take a look at that, which we have. The graphics in front of you show essentially an 11-foot travel lane, and then if we put in a 3-foot wide shoulder along the road. And Eastman Road has a lot of character to it. It's an older town road. It has a lot of mature trees, a lot of stone walls, a lot of areas where the slopes and the trees come right up to the edge of the road. In some cases, the power poles are right up next to the edge of the road. If we were to try to construct a shoulder along the road, what would happen is it would require ledge removal in these areas here. It would require a fair amount of cuts, and in order to have stable embankments, when we widen the road out, we lose a lot of these mature trees along the edge of the road. This graphic here shows that also along the edge of the road. Staff has looked at this, and I believe Maureen has also provided a recommendation in there that staff concurred that from a functional standpoint, from an aesthetic standpoint, it really wouldn't be worth going forward with that level of improvement.
The other thing is there would be a significant cost associated with that because of the amount of work to deal with drainage, to deal with just the cost of construction, the ledge cuts, all of those sort of factors. And the developer is already proposing to make a number of significant infrastructure improvements and is trying to keep the cost within reason on these, trying to hit $400,000 or under for these units. And incrementally, those costs are adding up, so the developer is trying to stay within that market range. But we offered to take a look at that. We went out, took some photos, took a look at what might happen if we were to do that. I wanted to spend just a couple of minutes also going back over the buildings for the project. The buildings, as I indicated, are a single-story building, a combination of duplexes, and what you see here is the duplex and quadruplexes. The design has been set up as a single-story design, and that's purposely done so that it accommodates the market group that we're trying to have purchases. That group, we're not restricting it specifically to that group because there might be those folks that are maybe not at the 55 but might be empty nesters looking to move into a facility like this. So we're trying to keep some flexibility in it, but we're pretty confident that the group we're aiming for is going to be marketed to this. The other thing you have to remember on a project like this, and I'll go back, is we're the land is most of it's going into open space. It's not really set up to accommodate families or kids in it. It has a lot of restrictions in it. Remember, they only own the inside of the units. The outsides have associations and restrictions, so the yard areas are limited. So it's really not appealing to anybody but somebody who wants to have the flexibility of having a unit that they can maybe go south during the winter months for and not worry about taking care of it, or while they're here, not to have to take care of the land at all. The one other thing that we talked about we mentioned in our memo was there was a recommendation from the town's peer review engineer about traffic calming on Eastman Road. And what we would, if you recall, the recommendation was that we look at setting up some sort of program to implement traffic calming if it's needed on the project. And that came from the fact that we weren't specifically restricting this to 55 and older. The traffic engineer felt that we should take a look at recounting the traffic at a later date should there be different demographics that move in here, which we don't think will happen at all. But we wanted to be responsive to that. So what is proposed in front of you and has been written into our submittal is that once these units are 75% occupied, we will reassess the traffic. We'll redo the traffic study. We'll look at the tenants that are in there. Are they in fact the empty nesters that we think that they will be, the 55 and older group? If 75% if that 75% of the build out of this are in fact the empty nesters, then we're proposing to do nothing more on it, because by the traffic counts, this generates a very low traffic volume. In fact, the town's traffic peer review engineer in his original review said that, you know, under either circumstance, whether this was developed as 55 older or some other demographic moved in, even under the most conservative condominium, the road still has the capacity to handle the traffic, and that's right in his memorandum. But we are willing to come back and are proposing to come back to reassess the traffic at 75% build-out level. And if the traffic shows that the demographics are different or more than 25% are not 55 and older, then we'll meet with the Public Works Director, and we'll meet with the town staff, and we'll look at the following traffic calming provisions. One is looking at additional signage along Eastman Road. Maybe signage that would say things like radar enforced, you know, slow down, changing the speed limits if we have to, some level of those sort of traffic calming measures. Now, I understand, and we all understand, that, you know, some people just ignore them and speed, but others will pay attention to them. And Eastman Road, if you drive down it, by nature, has a lot of curves, and it feels, because of the trees and the character of that road, it feels tighter. And when Paul Godfrey was on the planning board here, one thing that we had talked about was that, you know, if we say we built that shoulder and widened it out, we cleared the canopy, and we made other improvements, structural improvements to Eastman Road, if people feel more comfortable, and they're going to drive faster on a road. For instance, if you build a road that, you know, is long and flat and has great visibility, people have a tendency to drive to the conditions of the road. And that was discussed at the last meeting. So what we're proposing is to try to preserve that existing character of Eastman Road, maybe put some additional signage if we need to, and structural measures as far as speed tables go. And I know that, you know, that is something we have to talk about with the staff. I think that at, you know, Public Works and a police level, we need to make sure that they're comfortable with doing speed tables. Speed tables do slow down traffic, but then it also has, there's wintertime maintenance and plowing and that sort of thing that has to be considered into it. But those are the traffic calming measures that we would be glad to look at. We just don't foresee this development generating the type of traffic that would change the traffic patterns or change the capacity of Eastman Road. And again, that was reviewed through the town's peer review engineer. Utilities, I just wanted to spend a couple of minutes talking about utilities on the project. It's all underground power, electric, cable, telephone utilities for the project. There will be street trees within the project. There will be a sanitary sewer and a pump station, which will go right here in this location. And that pump station will pump through a force main out on Eastman Road up to the gravity sewer, which is just about up here. As we put in the sewer, one thing we talked about, and it's written into the plan, is that we will stub services out to the lots as we come by. The town has offered to reimburse the developer for the cost of putting those services in, up to $3,500, Joel, I think it is. Was it, Maureen, was it 35 or 33? 3,000, sorry, 3,000. Whatever that cost was is what would be reimbursed to the developer for doing that. So they would be willing to do that. A couple of other quick features to note on the project. We have a looped driveway access that comes through the site. Over here is the Mary Brock residence, which we've talked about before. We have worked with the town peer review engineer and have made some adjustments to this road location here to try to pull it as much as we possibly can away from the Brock property. And we are proposing to do a pretty heavy screening of landscaping along that property line. And we had originally proposed a fence. The developer's willing to do either or. The developer has met with Mary Brock and has talked to her about the landscaping. So we have a proposal on the table for the types of trees and the landscaping that would go in to provide some level of buffering.
How about the sidewalk there?
Yes, there is a sidewalk that is that runs on this side, right up here, and it runs all the way up through and connects into the trail system. So there is a 5-foot sidewalk on the project.
And that impacts the wetland?
that does impact the wetland.
At the 150 feet of wetland disturbance?
Actually, the, it's more than that now. It's about, I want to make sure I got that. Let me get my, the total wetland alteration on the property is 14,140 feet. 12,831 feet is this location right here, which is that wetland that was out in the field. We've had that reviewed by the Army Corps, DEP, and we've gone to the Conservation Commission. Everybody was agreeable to us altering that wetland. We're not putting any buildings in it. We're actually going to contour it, we're going to landscape it, and we're going to plant it with a wetland knee mix, a wetland seed mixture, and leave it as an open area in there. But right now, it was part of the historic agricultural field. It's not very neat or tidy, and we think we can enhance that by planting. The other wetland that we talked about, we had 150 square feet when we were before the board the last time in here. That has since increased to 1,309 square feet, and that has increased because of trying to pull this road a little bit away from the Brock residence here and give a little more space so that we can get some landscaping and buffering in through here. We had originally shown a stockade fence along the property because the road was almost right up against the property line. And in meeting with the town engineer and staff, the thought was, is let's see if we can slide that road over a little bit, provide a little more space between that and landscape it instead of putting a fence up through there. And we have been able to accomplish that on these plans. The consequence is about 1,300 square feet of wetland alteration. That is a RP2 wetland, so it's not an RP1 wetland. That sort of alteration is allowed. We're still under 15,000 square feet of total wetland alteration. 15,000 square feet is the magic number the DEP enforces for wetland mitigation. In other words, if you go over 15,000 square feet of wetland alteration, you have to mitigate those impacts. And we have met and reviewed those alterations with the DEP and Army Corps in the past and do have support for getting a permit to do those. So yes, there is a bit of a change here from 150 up to 1,300 square feet. You know, we're trying to strike a balance between respecting the Mary Brock residence, keeping a sidewalk access, and trying to install some landscape buffering. So this has been quite a process. We've even looked all the way back to only doing an emergency access through this location, gated, maybe a gravel or a grassed emergency access. I think, Maureen, it's safe to say the fire chief doesn't, or nor Public Works really supports that sort of an option. And I don't think Maureen does either. So, and that's really from a public safety. The issue is you know, it's gated. It's not, you know, over time, those can have a tendency to be forgotten about, not maintained the way they should. Whereas is we keep it as a looped driveway access to the property, it will be maintained in perpetuity as part of the project.
And Owens, the sidewalk is, as it's oriented there, to the easterly side of the road?
Yes, that's correct. It's on this side.
I noticed Mary, Mrs. Brock doesn't want that sidewalk there. I remember she sent a letter.
No, she doesn't. let me say that this was something we've talked about in great depth with staff. I think it's fair to say that staff would like to have a second connection to the trail system through there, and we're certainly willing to accommodate that. The wetland, you know, the wetland alteration, it's really a fringe alteration along the edge. We're disturbing a strip along the edge. So, yes, it is a wetland alteration, but it's not like we're fragmenting a wetland. We're just disturbing the fringe of it. And we think that, you know, there's a pretty good public benefit to provide that access through the development. Back over into this piece on Sprague property. It's a pretty nice piece of land back there. There's some trail networks that work up through there,
The goal was to try to make that a benefit to the project. So we'll leave that up to the board if we want to keep the sidewalk in or not, but we've spent a lot of time working with staff to try to fit a sidewalk in and provide that connection. And Elaine, I have one thing we added to the plan that I think you asked for the last one. It doesn't show on this graphic, but if you look on our site plans, the open space area, there's a hatched area now that around the open space so that it clearly delineates the limits of that open space. I think we talked about that at the last meeting, so.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So that is now shown on the plans, and that's on sheet 2 of 18, and it's kind of a hatched area all the way around the property. With that, Joel, do you have anything else you wanted to add to this? We're certainly here to answer any questions. Tonight, what we're seeking for is a preliminary approval of the project. If that were to happen, our next step is to file our site location permit with the Maine Department of Environmental Protection. We would like to get a preliminary approval before filing that so that we know that we're heading in the right direction. When we submit that site location permit, that's going to take the better part of 5 to 6 months to get through. It's just their process. Statutory law, I think they have 6 months to process it, 1 month to accept or reject the application. We've already had our pre-application meeting with the DEP. We've had a public informational meeting. Actually, we've had two public informational meetings right here at the town office. So if we were to receive preliminary approval within the next week or two at the outside, we would then be filing our site location permit. And there'll be a lag time. It would probably be 4 to 6 months before we're back to the board for a final approval. During the course of that time, we would continue to work with Steve Harding over at Ost Associates, who's the town peer review engineer. They go through their technical review comments. He's issued a memorandum that mostly technical things, talking about sewer slopes and that sort of thing. It's in your packet. And those are pretty customary and typical that we address through the between preliminary and final review. Thank you.
Barbara, are we letting public speak tonight at all?
No, this is not a public hearing. Who has questions?
Well, I want to, as a technical matter, Maureen was kind enough to prepare a memorandum for us, and I just want to make sure that I'm correct, Maureen. On page 2, paragraph 3, with respect to the sidewalk, you had said that there would be 150 feet of altered wetlands, but that number I just heard has changed.
It has changed, yes.
Okay. So, Owens, you had said that's 1,300?
1,309 square feet, I believe. Make sure I read that correctly. 1,309 square feet, yes.
Do you have any, or do you agree with all the comments from the town engineer? There's a letter attached to this.
Yeah. They're fine. A lot of the comments are, for instance, dealt with some of the waivers. Well, the waivers we're asking, they concurred with our reasoning for it. They offered some comments. I think there was some, I think one comment was about the location of the fire hydrant.
Right.
And all that's fine. Those are the normal things we deal with between preliminary and final. And we've actually met with them a couple of times, so we'll have all that worked out before filing.
Other questions? I have some. I always have some.
I would have some.
Right. One question that will be easy for you to answer. The blasting, are you going to have a blasting mitigation plan submitted with your final approval?
Yes,
that's all I want to know.
Okay. We have to follow the DEP and that'll.
Oh, okay. I mean, I just want to know what's going to be. You're going to show us something.
Yes.
When we get to that point, there's no point in belaboring it right now. Originally there were no vernal pools, and then somebody found three. It probably has to do with the different time that they went out to look. And I just want to be clear about this. One of them apparently is located, I couldn't find them on any of the plans?
Let me, that's because they're in the open space, and we actually had gone through all of that with...
Right, but one is on the western part of the open space, and...
I can certainly point those out. The first vernal pool is right here in this location. There's a pretty nice wetland all the way down here on the Sprague property, which is better part of 1,000 feet from where we're at. There's another vernal pool that sets right in here. And then there's a last vernal pool that was identified in this area right here.
That's fine. There are two things in relation to density that I'd like to talk about. One is, I am really not clear, or I do not understand what the proposal is, and there were several different ways to deal with it, because it still seems to me that this 15,000 square feet from the house is included in the gross square footage, and I don't see why. I don't understand why or how, because it's essentially going to be a separate lot. So somebody has to explain that to me.
Well, maybe I seek a little help from Maureen to help me. I think it's because it's part of the original lot. So because it's part of the original lot, we have to count it.
The way you calculate density is you take the total gross area that the applicant has control over.
Oh, okay, so it doesn't have anything to do with the condominium complex itself.
No, because okay. You can actually have a development that mixes single-family homes with condominium units, similar to what happened in the Spurwink Woods project. And you calculate the density by taking the total area owned or under control by the applicant, and then you subtract out miscellaneous...
No, I understand all that. Now, in terms of, it does not have access on Tanager Way. So how are we going to provide access to this? You had several different things listed in here, and one of them seems like just leave it alone, which to me violates what it says in our zoning code. And another approach was to allow a private access way.
Yeah,
now, what does that involve? I'm not clear about that.
Under the code, you're allowed to... and Maureen, if I get this wrong, I'll need your help to clarify it. But under the code, we're allowed to do a private access. We can create a private access way, and the way we do that is at right adjacent to that lot, we physically create a strip of land that shows on sheet 2 of 18 right up to the entrance, and it's designated as a 40-foot right of way.
I saw that on the plan.
Driveway. And that 40-foot right-of-way becomes a private way for a very short distance, I think of 20 feet. And that accommodates that requirement so that we designate it as a private way.
So what happens after the 40 feet? Just goes away?
It goes right back into the lot. Yeah.
It's a dead end, 20-foot long road.
Yep.
Okay.
And the access to the lot comes off of that new private road. Not off of Eastman Road.
Well, how does it come off the private road? It's not even near it.
There's a 40-foot wide right-of-way that's been created off of Eastman Road in a perpendicular from Eastman Road. And that's...
Right here.
Yes. This right here. 40-foot. Right here is a road. 40. It's 40 feet wide, and it goes from here to here. And then from off the end of it is the driveway into the single-family lot.
So the driveway into the lot is already there.
It is. We have to actually physically make some improvements to it. Sheet 3 of 18 shows those improvements. We're obligated to construct, and for that first 20 feet, we have to be 18 feet wide with 15 inches of MDOT gravel. Total 6 inches. Let's see, 6 inches of base gravel, 12 inches of aggregate gravel, and then 2 inches of pavement, and let me back up here again. 12 inches of sub-base gravel, MDOT, 6 inches of base gravel, 2 inches of base pavement, and 1.5 inches of surface pavement, which is your private way standard. So for the first 20 feet, 1 inch. Private road, thank you. So we need to build that first 20 feet to that town standard.
And what was the third alternative?
The third alternative dealt with something similar to how the board responded to the Leighton Farms subdivision. When we did the Leighton Farms subdivision over off of Wells Road, there was an existing farmhouse there. And the applicant did a subdivision over there. And the farmhouse, we created its own lot, 15,000 square foot lot, not unlike we're doing here. And I think the approach that was taken was is that that farmhouse had some rural character to it and, you know, sort of trying to preserve the old farmstead. And it seemed like the best way to do that was preserve everything in its, in its original condition as a lot. So the board allowed us to do that. In this case, you know, if the board doesn't like to feel comfortable with that option, the 40-foot right-of-way is a designated piece of property area, and nobody will drive by. When you drive by it, you won't know that there's a 40-foot right-of-way there, but what you will see is an 18-foot wide paved driveway apron for 20 feet long into the lot. And 18 feet, you know, a typical driveway, a normal driveway is probably 12 to 14 feet in width, so it's a little bit wider than a normal driveway. And can the board waive the width down? So there's an option there that the board could...
We could waive it and still have that right-of-way. Okay. But that's the third way, and we have the first way, but I don't understand the second way, I guess, just so we have all the options that we have with that. I mean, the first one is to leave it as a rural, or one is to leave it, and the second is to put a right-of-way in.
First is rural, second...
The first way, which the applicant is not proposing, would be to... would be to basically contrive driveway access from Tanager Lane to the farmhouse lot.
Yeah, okay.
That would be very cumbersome.
The second option is what the applicant is proposing, which is to create an actual private road from which the lot gains access. Mm-hmm. And then the third option was to treat this as an existing access, not a brand new access.
Okay.
Explain the third one to me. So what does that mean?
It means that you're recognizing, well, you did it in Leighton, you did it. The planning board approved a lot in Leighton Farms. Leighton Farms is off of Wells Road, next to Cross Hill. There was a farmhouse very close to the road. Mm-hmm. As I argued in Cape Elizabeth, the idea of rural character is very highly cherished. Mm-hmm. And I think rural character includes having those farmhouses along the road. And farmhouses most of them tend to be very close to the road. So if you can preserve the farmhouse and it's an existing condition or a little renovated, I think you can preserve the rural character of the road. And if you have to force them to put their driveway someplace else, you sometimes end up forcing other things on that house. So the idea is just leave it the way it is. Treat it as an existing condition. You're not creating a new access point. You have an existing access point already.
Okay, so on this plan where the right-of-way curb cut currently shows...
Yeah, and the concept would be this isn't a new lot. It's a remnant from the existing lot. So new lots still have access off of new roads. But this is the little piece of land that's left over from the existing lot that is being developed.
And so the only effective ingress-egress to the farmhouse would be off of the new private access road.
Right, which is the existing driveway.
I'll tell you what I'm uncomfortable with about not about doing that. And that is that when it came to what was originally Spurwink Woods, we required them to make the access on a house that was already existing off the new road. And now it seems to me changing rules. And I have a little trouble with that. You know, where you require one person to do one thing and another to do another. So, and as far as rural character is concerned, well, this whole...
We're not requiring them to do that. It's an option. It is an option for them. There's just a different, another option. I don't remember us requiring
that. We did. We said that they could not have the access off the original road. We made them put, change the access for that existing house that came in off the new road.
I just don't remember.
I do.
Just for purposes of showing cards, I'm in favor of the 40-foot right-of-way off Eastman Road, as shown on the plan.
I just think it's more common sense. I mean, it's there.
Which is what they're proposing, right?
Yeah.
Right. So I'm saying, you know, to require them to do it so it meets...
I remember us talking about making them do it off Tanager Lane, and there was some rule. I don't remember now why.
Well, the rule is you have to, if a road is existing prior to 1997, then you can't connect to that. But this is requiring them to make a different, you know, a new access way, essentially, which would meet, seems to me...
What they're proposing is fine.
Right, right. But I'm just saying to do nothing, I have trouble with. Just, you know, saying... Okay.
If it would be appropriate, it seems like we're sort of heading into the direction of the 40-foot right-of-way. In order to not make the driveway, you know, an 18-foot wide driveway to one house seems quite a bit, but maybe we could do the 40-foot right-of-way but pursue a waiver to go down to 12 or 14 feet in width, and then that way, as you drive by and look at it, it looks just like a driveway going into a house, but there'll be a 40-foot right-of-way attached to it. If that's reasonable.
Anybody have any?
I'm not so sure that I'm in favor of that. I'm curious because I think the standard then gets watered down for all subsequent developments as well. I'd like to hear the town planner's comments with regard to that. Maureen, do you have an opinion?
I frankly think that there are times when we need to make the ordinance work for existing situations. Mm-hmm. And I don't, with respect to the chair, there's always a time, I don't think we ought to be, and this is hard for me to say because I am a slave to the rules of the ordinance, but I think there are times when we need to look at the bigger picture and the whole idea of preserving the rural character of that road, mm-hmm. and roads like Wells Road as much as possible, I think really speaks to a lot of what the town has said are its fundamental goals.
So could
and
we?
We've got this rule, and the point of the rule, and to speak to Mr. Humer's comments, the rule says that if you're going to create a subdivision, mm-hmm. your driveways to your individual lots or your individual units have to be off a new road. And the goal of that is to not allow someone to take a strip of land adjacent to, say, Wells Road and run half a dozen driveways on these little narrow lamb chopped or flag lots. And that goal, I think, is a very good goal. But that goal, which is represented by this rule, isn't the problem here. The problem is we have one, you know, existing farmhouse. The developer could propose, quite frankly, to tear the farmhouse down, mm-hmm. and use that spot and build another condominium unit. And I don't think the condominium unit would add to the character of Eastman Road the way preserving the farmhouse will add to the character. And for that reason, I'm willing to be a little bit more flexible with this rule and also note it down as one of those things we may need to adjust in the future in the ordinance.
Fair. Given that rationale, then, does it make sense to construct the road to nowhere? Or do we just reserve the right of way?
The board has the authority to provide waivers to road standards. So you have waived a road standard down to 12 feet for an existing road that served, I think it was 3 to 4 homes. So if you were to go down to 18 or even 14 feet here, I don't think you would be creating a precedent that would create problems for you in the future.
Okay. You've swayed me. I think 12 or 14 foot blacktop road would be acceptable. I do, however, think that the 40-foot right-of-way should be reserved in that space.
Okay.
Irrespective of what road is actually created and the width of the road, I think the right-of-way should be shown on the land records.
Fair enough.
And that's what's showing in there
that's
now.
That's what's
so
shown on the plan is the 40-foot right away.
I have more.
Sure.
We have more. Does anybody else want to say something before I go on with that?
I just want to make sure we're going to hit all the points in Maureen's memo. So you're going.
Well, a lot of these are that and some of the letters, too.
Can I
I clarify one more thing here? Am I correct that this private roadway is going to be owned, is going to be part of the farmhouse lot and owned by the owner of the farmhouse lot, or is the private roadway somehow in different ownership?
It would be owned by the farmhouse owner.
So the farmhouse lot?
Yep.
Would include the private roadway?
That's correct.
Is that a change from last time? I thought we had said that in order to satisfy the technical requirements, that the farmhouse was actually going to be considered part of the condominium.
That was if we didn't do something along these lines. We had proposed as one option just to eliminate the property line around the farmhouse and make it a condominium as part of the development. But the applicant, we would really like to preserve it as its own individual lot because it is unique, and to roll it into the condominium just didn't feel like that would be an appropriate fit. So,
so it is a separate legal fee simple lot that will have a right-of-way, a 40-foot right-of-way direct access.
That is correct.
There. Thank you.
Of course, the other way to get rid of it is just take it out of the whole calculation and sell it off and forget about it. I know.
The applicant actually asked me that question. And in order for them to legally do it at this point in time, they would have to withdraw their subdivision application from the planning board's consideration.
Well,
then they could chop it off, and then they could resubmit their application. They didn't seem to want to jump.
No.
I'd like... Talking about density also, because that seems to be that in traffic, and I think you've gone through the traffic very thoroughly. And I've also, as I say, I've driven the road quite a few times, just making sure that visually I see the road squeezed in less. And I'd like to talk at some point about how we can get something done to pave the whole road, you know, maybe get the town to pave the other half or something. But maybe that's part of final subdivision approval, because that's something we really need to talk about, is how do we get the town, you know, you have half the road paved beautifully and the other half paved horribly. Just throw that out there. In terms, there was a very long letter from Mr. Plimpton talking about density, and he did mention this piece on the top of, it's on page 2 of 18, the part of the wetland that is totally separate. And I think we talked briefly about this once before, and it is totally separate, and there is something in the code that says you're not allowed to count things when they're totally separate in net residential density. And that's part of the definition of net residential density in the code.
Were you looking at?
It's on page 2 of 18, and it's this little tiny piece of land right up here next to the RP1 wetland.
Okay, right here.
And in here it does say that any portion of the site that is regularly, any isolated portion of the site that is cut off from the main portion of the site by a road, existing land uses, or major stream or similar feature, such that it creates a major barrier to the common use or development of the site. And there is this little tiny piece of wetland sitting up here at the top that I think is, isn't that part of the RP2, or am I reading that wrong? At least on the map of the wetlands, that's shown as RP2 next to RP1.
This is RP1 wetland.
It's on page 14.
This is all RP1 wetland through here.
Are you including that piece up there?
That piece up there? No, that's upland. That is not a wetland.
That's RP2, isn't it? Or it's...
No. The wetland boundary is right here.
Okay, well that's what Mr. Plimpton did refer to, and that is in the code as a portion that you cannot count as part of your net residential acreage.
We've talked about this in the past on it. That piece of land up there is... And maybe Maureen can jump in here at some point on this, but my understanding is if there's a piece of land that is isolated and completely cut off that you can't get to for any type of a use, then in that situation,
you would need to deduct it because you can't have any use of it. Now, this piece of land up here, and we had actually talked about it at one point, we could construct a trail up through here that would be another connection from Eastman Road as part of the project development. That land has value, that land has use, it has direct access to Eastman Road.
Via the upland.
Via the upland.
Does that connect to the open space?
Yes.
At Winter Woods? I guess I should have asked that question.
Yes, it does.
Okay, so that it is usable then?
Yes.
Okay.
And we even contemplated building a trail at one point, so.
Okay. As long as we can confirm that that is usable land and that we can get from here to there on it and that it does meet the code requirements, that's my only concern with it. Does anybody have any questions about that at all? The traffic, in terms of the, and I don't know, this may be something for final review too. Would we talk about escrowing money in the final review for any traffic mitigation at that point? Okay, that's fine.
Yep, we understand that.
So that answers that question too. And...
And just on that point, will the final review permit us the opportunity to revisit the potential contribution with regard to the paving of Eastman Road in lieu of a right-of-way pedestrian access?
Okay, and is that part of the final, would that be part of the final review too? We need to absolutely make sure that is. Because I think the whole road should be paved. It's not in good shape.
We'll certainly look at that and talk with Public Works. The only thing I would add is that this developer is running sewer up on one side, and I guess, not guess, I know that, you know, the costs are, you know, we've experienced a lot of incremental costs, and to go to, you know, for the developer to absorb paving a full road.
Well, I'm not saying necessarily that the developer has to absorb it, but I think we need to figure out how to get it paved, because having half a road paved is ridiculous when the road isn't in good condition.
Maybe we could speak with the Public Works Director.
Whatever, no, but we do need to discuss that.
I feel it's a coordination effort with the town.
Okay. Absolutely.
That it would be appropriate for the developer to make a contribution toward.
Absolutely.
That. So, you know, I reserve the right at final approval to revisit that.
Fair enough.
Yeah, could I just address that? I've been to the budget meetings with the council.
Yeah.
And there's not a lot of money out there. And I don't know if anybody's gone to the transfer station lately, but the town has made its top priority trying to reconstruct Spurwink Ave. And I would strongly urge the planning board to avoid telling the council which road is the highest priority that needs to be paid.
And duly noted, that's not my intent. My intent is simply that the developer should have coordinated effort with the Public Works Department with regard to the road, specifically during the digging up of the road for the installation of a sewer. So I would like to reserve the right to, at final approval, find out where that conversation went, particularly given the fact, as we know, that road is not in good repair currently.
Fair enough.
And I only have two other quick things.
Sure.
On the stormwater runoff, and I have to confess I find that part of this to read just a nightmare. But could you please, it talks about the 29 catch basins, essentially, that are going someplace. And I never could find out where that someplace was.
I would be glad to speak about that.
Owen's Liz for this. Owen's Liz for this.
Yeah, well, the stormwater rules and regulations have grown a lot over the past few years, is putting it politely. And just to walk through that real quick, we have to comply with the Chapter 500 stormwater regulations that the state of Maine adopted. And those regulations now focus on not only detaining the runoff, but treating the runoff from the development. And so we're going to treat over 90% of the runoff from the impervious surfaces. And Nate, is it 80% for the landscaped areas? Except for the linear portion, which is 75.
But the 90% is for roofs, roadways, is 80%.
And 80%.
And the total developed area is 50%.
So we have to capture that drainage, and then we treat it. And the way we're going to do that is the catch basins that Barbara spoke about are scattered throughout the road system. They collect the water when it rains, just like on any other street. And then those pipe to a stormwater detention and treatment pond that is in this area here. And this is a, if your plans, if you want to see what one looks like, I think there's plans in there. If you go to sheet 3 and 4, actually it's sort of on both sheets. Sheet 4 shows it better. It shows the design and the grading around the pond, which is a bunch of lines, but essentially what it is the water goes into the pond, it fills up to a fairly shallow, if you're looking, you see where the existing pond is? This is on sheet 4 of 18 that I'm looking at. Right to the right of the existing pond, you see an area that's graded, and it shows a bunch of lines in it. Some of those lines are contour lines, and some of those lines are what they call under-drainage pipes that are underneath the pond. So the water comes into the pond, fills up, it infiltrates or filtrates through the soil media, which is a specially designed soil media that removes nitrogen, total phosphorus, the nutrients, that sort of thing. And then it gets collected in these under drains, and then it gets discharged. And it's pretty clean water when it gets discharged out of the pond. Now that these aren't, this, when I call this a pond, it's not a pond in the sense that you traditionally see a pond that, you know, is a deep dug pond. These are shallow ponds that will only hold water for 24 to 72 hours. Within the pond. They drain out completely, and they're generally vegetated in the bottom. And many times it grows in and looks almost like a grassed area, and then it ponds temporarily during a storm event. And then the water discharges from there.
And then, okay, so there are two of those.
Actually, it's one.
Okay, so all 29 go into the one.
That's correct.
And
so,
yes.
So the pond that is shown in the south left-hand corner of your overall plan, that's a wet pond.
This pond right here?
That's a wet pond.
Yeah, and that's an existing farm pond that we're not introducing any of the storm drainage
so
into.
The only drainage is into the dry pond that you just discussed.
That's correct, yeah.
Dale Brewer wrote a letter about high-intensity soil, and you have had a high-intensity soil rate class B. And then DEP goes back in and digs more test pits. He talked about, you know, making sure everything goes in the right place, and you've seen that letter, I'm sure. But you had a class B high-intensity. You're asking for a waiver, but you had one. And I guess that's what I don't understand.
The Class B high-intensity soil survey was a DEP requirement, and so we assembled one for the DEP. I think what I was more, and which is fine for the town too, I think what I was more looking for the waiver on was the lot-by-lot soil suitability analysis, because
we don't have any lots.
Right. Just one lot.
Okay, but essentially there is a high intensity soil survey that has been done.
That's correct.
Okay, all right.
So technically we don't really need the waiver for that. Okay. Maureen, it's class B. The ordinance doesn't require class A. It's a class. Is it a class B?
It's a class A.
So then we do need the waiver for that. That must.
Now that I think of it.
Which you've already received.
Yes, at the completeness review. That's correct.
Yeah, I just didn't understand that because here I'm reading a soil survey, and you're asking for a waiver, and I'm not...
Now that this comes back to me...
Getting it.
That's right. It was a Class A at the town level. The DEP, as part of the site location, requires a Class B soil survey. And that has to do with the mapping units, how accurately you map the soils down to. So we needed to ask for a waiver at the town level because of the Class A. But we just included the Class B soil survey for information.
And the only thing I'd like to ask the board is, just so that we sort of finish, I'm not sure we completely finished, is about that sidewalk on the eastern side of the property that Mrs. Brock really didn't want to have. And I can see how it's connecting to those trails on Winnick Woods, if everybody feels that it is very important to have that, so that we, I mean, that's been a high priority. So I don't guess, those are all my questions. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I want to just hit the highlights on Maureen's now with regard to the right-of-way. The resolution there is it's a 20-foot right-of-way, is that correct?
No, 22.
There's no right-of-way.
Oh, right-of-way. Yeah, they want a waiver for the right-of-way because it's condominium complex.
Okay, so I understand that. The sewer, 9735 gallons is the new number?
That is correct. We actually updated, had Public Works Director update his memorandum, which is in this most recent submittal.
And Maureen, is it appropriate then that there be concurrent resolutions, one from the Planning Board recommending that this be designated as a sewer service area?
Yes. The council will not formally make a decision. Not sure if you're aware, but because this is a major subdivision approval, it's a two-step approval process, preliminary and final, and the applicant is required, prior to coming back to you for final approval, they have to go back to the council and get what they call conditional municipal approval. And if you make the motion at this time for the sewer, then the council can make that final decision at that conditional municipal approval phase.
Okay, thank you.
He owns that 9735 gallons, that per day?
Well, I'm going to have to look at that in the book here. I believe that is per day, but let me want to make sure I'm correct in that. So, total is 9,735 gallons per day, and yes, which accounts for 46 two-bedroom units.
Good.
And the existing farmhouse.
Anybody have any other questions? A motion for the board to consider that?
I'll move. Can we dispense with the reading of the findings of the facts, or is that required?
You have to read the findings of the facts.
Okay. I'd like to move that given that Wiley Enterprises LLC is requesting review for Eastman Meadows, a 46-unit condominium with clubhouse and one single-family lot located at 68 Eastman Road, which requires review under Section 16-2-4, Major Subdivision Review, Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Standards, and Section 19-7-9, Subpart D, Private Roads. And the town engineer has identified further refinement of the plans, which should be included in the final application submission. And further, the application substantially complies with Section 16-3-1, Subdivision Standards, Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Standards, and Section 19-7-9, Subpart B, Private Roads. Therefore, be it moved that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Wiley Enterprises LLC for preliminary subdivision approval, a resource protection permit, and a private road approval for Eastman Meadows, a 46-unit condominium with clubhouse and one single-family lot located at 16 Eastman Road, be approved subject to the following conditions. One, that the plan submitted for final approval address the comments of the town engineer in his letter dated May 13, 2008.
We need a two about the right-of-way.
And two, that the 40-foot right-of-way is shown on the plan?
No, that's already in there, but we need a, they're asking for a waiver for the right-of-way because it's a condominium complex. Since, is that not correct? You would like that as part of the, formally as part of the conditions?
Yes.
Isn't that correct?
Yes. I'm not following you.
That, remember we talked about a right-of-way for the roads, and because it's a condominium complex, we'll just have 22-foot roads, but there aren't any lots off it.
Are you talking about the private road with the farmhouse, or?
No, the private roads within the condominium complex.
Which is now 22 feet.
Which is now 22 feet, but they're asking for us to formally give them a waiver for that.
It's in the letter from the engineer, so did you just?
Oh, is that in the letter from the engineer?
Number 10.
Yeah.
Number 10.
Actually, the engineer and the public works director both commented that they didn't.
Okay, I think that's okay, since it's in there.
I thought it was included in the.
I read it, and I have it in green, but I, that's fine.
So my motion stands.
Do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All in favor?
Thank you for your time.
No,
we have another motion.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'd also like to move that the planning board recommend to the town council that the lot located at 16 Eastman Road be designated a sewer service area to allow public sewer to be expended at the developer's expense to the new Eastman Meadows condominium project.
Second.
Question? All in favor?
Now you can thank.
Thank you. Have a good evening.
All right. The next matter is the BA Wetlands Amendment. And have any discussion about this? We're in the process. Yes.
Where do you stand on the wetland map?
It's been ordered. And
what's the timing? What's the timing of the wetlands map?
You might want to wait for Marty.
Oh, okay.
She's.
Okay. Yeah, it's not done. She's ordered. It's going to be a couple months. It's going to be June. So.
Your public comments.
No, not on this tonight because there aren't any. There isn't anything on this. But we talked about considering everything as one package in the BA district.
I guess I'm reluctant to consider, although I understand their reasons perhaps to expedite this. I'm reluctant to do anything at all definitive until we have that map.
How would that change your mind on the wetland setback, though, whether we revise that or the district zoning or not? How would that change the wetland part?
I think that changing the wetland needs to be done, if not exactly on the same track as the other work we're doing for the BA zone, certainly with the additional knowledge of the wetlands that are involved, that we're going to have from the wetland map, so that we know where it is in the town that's being affected by this reduction of the setback that we're considering. It just seems to me that if we're spending the money to have this wetlands mapping done before we do things that alter the effect of the boundaries of it, we need to know where it is.
I agree completely.
What's on the agenda tonight is just to put it with the package.
Right.
Yeah, well, we have to make that decision tonight.
Like
and
to
it seems
motion.
To me, please.
I'd like to move that based on the information presented, the Business A wetland amendments that allow the RP1 buffer to be reduced to 100 feet and that allow expansion of nonconforming uses where there are no exterior changes located in section 19-6-9 of the zoning ordinance be joined with the ongoing BA district zoning overhaul in one package. As one package, pardon me.
Second? Discussion?
I did. I had a quick question, though. Maureen, can you just give us a quick status of the wetlands mapping?
The wetlands mapping, well,
that part is going well. I think I forwarded to you the contract that we signed. We retained Woodlot Alternatives, which is now actually Stantec. But they are the firm that we've used in the past. I consider them to be very reputable, so I'm expecting good quality work from them. They gave us a proposal for three pieces of work. One was to map the wetland on the west, on the land side of Route 77, or the west side of Route 77. Mm-hmm. And they would go as far as they needed to for that wetland to determine that it was at least 2 acres. And they give us a lot of information with that. They look at significant habitat as part of their regular work and as vernal pools. And that is what we could afford under our budget. There were two other pieces we had asked for. One, to do a functions and values assessment. If we got the functions and values assessment, it would exceed our $5,000. So we did not contract for that. We had also asked them for an estimate for how much it would cost to map the wetland on the east side of Route 77. And that was almost as much as it cost to map the wetland on the west side. So that was also well beyond our budget. So we have signed the contract. They told me that they're expecting to get the work done by mid-June.
And does that include responding to questions from us?
I think he'll come to one meeting. I actually will have to actually check that. Okay, they have agreed to do the following. They have not included attending a meeting as part of that. They'll prepare a brief narrative report describing the delineation methods, the wetland classifications and characteristics, the local, state, and federal wetland regulations that may affect development of the site. They will GPS survey data of the wetland boundary so that we can produce that on a map. They'll have control points. The map will show both 100-foot and 250-foot buffers. They'll be using a global positioning system. They'll be going out there with flagging. They'll identify wetlands of special significance. That will include contacting the Natural Resources Agency at the state level. They'll also describe how this is characterized using the Army Corps of Engineers Wetland Delineation Manual. If we want them to come to a meeting, because we have not spent our entire budget, I think we can ask them to do that.
Okay.
I guess before you vote, I just think when it's all said and done, our decision is going to be the same as if we were to decide now or wait till after the study is done. You know, I see where it's going. I just wanted to make my thoughts known, I guess.
Well, I think that we've been asked to consider a BA district, and we're sort of holding everything until we can make, sort of put a whole package together that makes some sense. And for me, I can't see proceeding on this until we know where the wetlands are.
I guess we'll agree to disagree.
That's
on
fine.
This part.
And take it up later.
Right. Okay. So we have a motion on the floor and a second. Any other discussion? Okay. All in favor? Opposed? Passes.
Motion carries.
Motion carries. 4-4, 1 against. Okay. All right, bed and breakfast. We're talking about, we've proposed amendments that would create a definition of homestay where up to 2 rooms may be rented to guests for any length of time. And a revised definition of bed and breakfast is also proposed. Bed and breakfast is limited to 6 rooms where meals may or may not be served to guests who can stay up to 14 days, that we would permit them in RA and RC districts, and would allow existing structure, conversion of existing structures to B&Bs, and also new constructions of structures as B&B. We have discussed, although not with a lot of agreement on some of our parts, beginning in the space and bulk standards section, existing structures can convert to a B&B on a lot of any size. B B&amp;B's proposed and new construction would need a minimum lot size of 80,000 square feet in the RA district, the same lot size required for individual single-family lots. New construction in the RC district would require 20,000 square feet. And there are, and there's been, Maureen, you have a change in number that's rather substantial here.
Yes, and I had done some work on the original maps I gave you, looked at arterials, collectors, and rural connectors. And because you were working on minimum lot sizes, I had broken the analysis into three groups for under each of those subgroups, three subgroups under each of those. One was lots between 20 and 40,000 square feet. One was lots between 40 and 80,000 square feet. And the third one was lots that are greater than 80,000 square feet. Those breaks were chosen because the minimum lot size in the RC district is 20,000 square feet. Minimum lot size in the RA district is 80,000 square feet. And those were the numbers you got. However, your final, well, your, the text you have before you tonight doesn't set a minimum lot size, because you're trying to wrap into this proposal the potential for existing homes on non-conforming lots to be able to convert to bed and breakfast. So the numbers you had before left out lots that were less than 20,000 square feet in size. So as I was redoing, I could have just left it out. I was looking at some of the data. I decided it would be a little bit more accurate if I just gave you these more gross numbers. And I need to caution you that I'm using the assessor's data. And as I was using the assessor's data, I found that, in fact, there's a few lots that don't have a lot size in the database, when, in fact, I know for a fact they do have a lot size. So there are a few that are missing. Clearly, those numbers are larger, but the vast majority of them would never convert to a bed and breakfast for lots of other reasons. So this is a very crude analysis, but it's just trying to give you an order of magnitude idea. If you look at the map I just put up, the areas that are in red are lots that have frontage on an arterial. And then the areas in blue are lots that have frontage on a collector. And those are the two numbers that you have in your report.
Where are the numbers? I don't see the numbers. 429, is that right?
Yes.
Yes, and originally it was 241.
Right, but that left out the lots that were less than 20,000 square feet in size.
And then also we have in the RA district the required amount of road feet for existing buildings and 125 for new construction. And road frontage is proposed to be 50 feet for existing buildings and 100 feet for new construction in the RC district.
And it needs to be clear that there is not a line in the database that has road frontage, so I was not able to sort out lots that had less than 50 feet of frontage. I also did not sort out lots that are in wetlands, or I couldn't make a determination whether there were lots that, because of their configuration or their size, couldn't accommodate parking that is required as part of it. So this is a very crude, gross analysis, and it doesn't get you where, you know, it doesn't give you a really good idea how many lots are going to be converted to bed and breakfast. It gives you an absolute maximum. It certainly can go higher than this, and it would probably be a much, much smaller number.
It couldn't go higher than this.
Couldn't go higher than this.
And as a procedural matter, tonight we will be hearing public comment.
Yes.
Yeah.
Public hearing scheduled for tonight.
And then the, is this a must approve as, no, so we have the opportunity.
We have, the sky's the limit. Yeah. We can either throw the whole thing in the garbage can, we can
okay.
We could send
work it on again.
So we can fiddle with it some more tonight. I mean, there's lots of,
okay.
This is an advisory role. The ultimate decision makers are the council on this. But usually we get to a point where we're comfortable with the recommendation and we ship it on, and then they tinker with it there too.
Thanks.
Okay. So if there's, is there anything else anybody wants to make a comment? I have to say before we open the public hearing that we have had quite a large number of emails, and I will say the emails are overwhelmingly negative, so that you all know that. And I will now open the public hearing. Please state your name and your address. And in the interest of time, could you please keep it quite brief? Thank you. Yes. You could just line up. Just get in the line.
Maureen, can I take down your...
Carl, what you want to do is take those two clips off and put them on your board.
Well, I think that he actually got up first and you're second, okay?
What?
What's your name, sir?
David Sanford.
I think there's another gentleman was in front of you, I believe, so you'll be second.
You'll be second, just wait right there, that's good.
Okay, I'll try to be brief, I know you've had a long...
Please be brief, it's been a long night.
I can just hold it, I don't mind just holding it.
Just work with Maureen.
Carl Dietrich, 500 Ocean House Road. I guess I was the original citizen who brought this before you. I'll be very brief. I just want to find out if it's going to become reality or not. I would like to have a bed and breakfast. I'd like to... I live on the busiest road, an arterial road in Cape Elizabeth. Have over 2 acres of mature trees and shrubs, over 400 feet. I think it's actually more like 600, which is bigger than Inn by the Sea. I have paved parking for at least 6 cars that can't be seen. Cape Elizabeth, very popular town. The little gift shop at the Portland Headlight. I'm just doing a quick review for people who don't know. The little two-car garage has over $600,000 selling trinkets. That means there's a lot of visitors. The cheapest room for 2008 this summer in Cape Elizabeth, if you have a guest, a friend, or relative, is $448.28, if it's available. That's the cheapest room, that's the only room. What I'm proposing to do, what I'd like to do, is rent one room, one bedroom in my house, with a bathroom, and this is the sign I would like to have. This is the actual exact sign. It's 3 inches by 20 inches long. The reason I'm doing this is just because of these couple of things. Gasoline is proposed to be $4 a gallon. Heating oil is going to be at least $4.25. The lock-in price is going to be $4.50. And the taxes are going up from the school budget. All I'd like to do is rent the one room out for the in the summer months, July and August. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is David Sanford. I live at 1 Charles Road. I wrote an email, which was distributed today. I'm assuming I don't need to reread it.
No, we all have it.
You all have it. Okay, to summarize briefly, my wife and I are concerned with that element of the amendment which might allow the property that abuts ours at 1 Charles Road, 553 Shore Road, to be zoned as a bed and breakfast. That particular property is all, for the last over a year, has been advertised on the internet on a site called Vacation Rentals by Owner as available for rent by the week for up to 7 to 10 people. I'm concerned because we live in a neighborhood in which homes are very closely together. And as I indicated on my email, there is literally no space whatsoever between, for example, the back of the garage at 553 Shore Road and our property at 1 Charles Road. 553 Shore Road is a very tall, large house that looms over our house and over 3 Charles Road next door. The property was rented last summer, and we had the frequent experiences that renters who were simply gathering in the backyard, having a good time, would do so until midnight or close to midnight. And in our home right next door, we could not sleep with the windows open. The houses are that close together. And my own sense and my wife's sense is that to allow 553 Shore Road or other houses in the same situation to be used as a B&B would have a very adverse effect on the neighborhood.
Do you know that you can file a complaint with the code enforcement officer? And you might want to call Maureen or the code enforcement officer and find out how to do it.
All right, thank you.
So.
What?
Sorry, can I rent out your home?
You can.
By the week?
Yes.
Sure.
And why do we need a homestead?
We've got a few in our neighborhood. Yeah, we've got a couple neighbors.
Oh, you're saying that, but he's saying they rent rooms.
No.
I'm saying what?
No, they're renting the house out by the week.
Right.
Are they renting the whole house out by the week?
House out.
Yeah, I couldn't tell from the internet site whether it was by the house or by the room. I don't know.
That would be a violation by the room.
It said, it said four rooms for rent.
If you feel it's, there's a violation, you can check the code, and if you feel there's a violation, you can file a complaint.
Thank you.
My name is David Freeman, 3 Charles Road, and I'm not going to go over the same issues that Dave went over. But I guess the question I would have is this public meeting is to go over this proposal. Is that not correct?
That's correct.
And not to air our grievances regard to the possibility of bed and breakfasts?
Yes.
Okay.
But you can air your grievances, too.
Well, I'd be saying the same thing. But the issue I would have is and correct me if I'm wrong, if that's possible, is a bed and breakfast, I would consider, and this homestay, I would consider it a business. So is the purpose of classifying it in this form to allow it to be put in a place in a residential area as opposed to having to go through a rezoning process as a business? Can you answer that question? Is that...
No, go ahead. You can do it, Maureen.
What the board is... The council asked the planning board to consider a request from a resident who wanted to operate a bed and breakfast in a residential district. Currently, bed and breakfasts are not permitted in residential district. They're permitted in the town center district, and that's it. So the planning board looked at the regulations and the way bed and breakfasts are regulated in other communities, and they came up with this proposal, and they're soliciting public input because they haven't made a recommendation to the council yet. And the proposal really is kind of two pieces. One is it looks at bed and breakfasts, it takes the existing bed and breakfast definition, and it beefs it up. It makes it more descriptive, more specific. And then the provision explicitly allows bed and breakfast to be a permitted use in the business, in the residential A and the residential C district, if a property has at least 50 feet of, has frontage on Shore Road, Mitchell Road, or Route 77. So if this were adopted, you could convert your home to a bed and breakfast.
One of the things we did put in there was you have to live there. You can't be an absentee B&B runner.
The other piece, the homestay piece, really is more of a cleaning up of the ordinance. If you look at the ordinance right now, it allows people to rent up to 2 rooms on a long-term basis. You could take in a student. It's just that if you look in each district, it says the renting of rooms for up to so many, and it just seems a very cumbersome way to state it. So instead, we created something called a homestay, and then we defined homestay to be the renting of 2 rooms up to so many times. So the homestay is really a lot more of cleaning up and a wordsmithing in the ordinance, but the bed and breakfast provision is clearly a new discussion. It says where bed and breakfasts are currently not allowed, they would be allowed in certain areas.
Certain areas.
Certain areas.
Not all the residential.
And it's not something the board has voted to endorse. They're soliciting public comment tonight.
And we did spend quite a bit of time of seeing where this would have effect, you know, what the parameters would be. I mean, it's a two-step, it's that's the wrong word, it's a two-tiered system.
Yes.
Is a better way to describe it.
Thank you. Well, in light of that, then, I just summarize and say that my wife and I would oppose classifying bed and breakfasts and allowing it to be in a residential area because we constitute it as a business, and therefore should be addressed as a business as opposed to allowing it in a residential area. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Emily Madison, and I live at 2 Charles Road, and I did send you an email. I can't see where the RA...
Go ahead and remove that so we can see the map. Thank you very much.
I don't know just how far down Shore Road it goes. But anyway, it would impact my neighborhood, which is really in the north end of the Cape. I live across the street from the Sanfords and the Freemans. And as I said in my email, Shore Road is interrupted at that part of the Cape very often. Usually there are only one or two houses before you're interrupted by a connecting road. So not only would the houses beside any house that's serving as a B&B be impacted by it, but also the houses behind them. And it's very densely populated. The lots are very small. I think that they would be larger than, I think we showed these.
We showed them.
Do you want to see these? These show the,
these were taken before and showed them to the county. The lots are very small, but the houses are set.
Are these all the same one?
Or different? No, they're not.
So it's here.
I just wonder, could you, I can't really see too well with this glasses on, but how far down Shore Road is residential A? Is all of this blue residential A?
Mrs. Madison?
Yes.
That doesn't show the residential A.
Oh, okay. Where is residential A?
It shows the colors refer to the road classifications.
Okay.
So the blue is collector roads, and all of Shore Road is a collector road. So starting from the South Portland line all the way to the town center, any lot on either side of that road could potentially be converted to a B&B under this proposal.
Okay. Well, of course, these are more, and the lot that the gentleman was speaking about before is quite different in size than the lots up here. Any of these houses, they're very, very small lots, and the houses seem to be set back on the lots, so the parking areas would be extremely congested, as you see in those photographs.
There would have to be a site plan review, though, and they would have to have on-site parking.
Yeah.
Which would eliminate a lot of properties.
Okay, but like my neighbors, I do oppose it. I can see where in some parts of the Cape, like the man was talking about with his property, it's quite a different thing than a B&B in our part of town would be. It would be different maybe even further down on Shore Road.
You know, and that's one of the reasons we're soliciting this input is because we tried to do our best with suggesting how it would work in certain areas, and it's good to hear some areas where it could be a problem.
You can see it's very densely populated. Sure. The houses are very close together.
And based on the regulations that are proposed, not and that we're working with, I'm not sure any of those houses would comply for B&B. I think at most they might be homesteads.
No, they would because it's there's no there are existing structures and there's no limitation to the lot size.
There isn't, but there is a restriction that you couldn't convert unless you got site plan review.
Okay.
So you'd have to come to this board and you'd have to meet the site plan standards. I think what Mr. Hayden is referring to is that most of those lots, there's no way they could convert to a business, a B&B, and still provide the parking that's required and the buffering that's required and, you know, the other standards of site plan review. So, you know, that was his reference. So while there isn't a fixed minimum lot size, the performance standards of site plan review would throw most of those lots out.
Oh, okay. Okay, thank you.
And we're still working with it.
Yeah.
My name is Edward Madison, and I agree with my wife and my neighbors. I'd just like to say that I think all BA zones are not created equal. And I'm a little concerned about setting precedents in one area that's going to impact another area, which is so different. And as my wife pointed out, she didn't mention it tonight, but if you walk beyond Cape Elizabeth and you start going to South Portland, you immediately notice the houses start to degenerate, the businesses, it just has a completely different feel than Cape Elizabeth. And so we're right on the cusp of the border there, and I think that we have to consider that anything that is done and establishes a precedent, and particularly where there's so little opportunity to have public input. I mean, if you say that this is going to go to site plan review and so forth, is there then additional time for us to have input, or is it just a dead matter then? I want to take advantage of what little time I have to get some input. So I think that's basically what I would like to say. These houses are very close together, further down in the Cape where people have larger lots. I find it hard to believe that some of the people on Shore Road have the estates would be terribly interested in having B&Bs right next to them, but maybe they would, I don't know. But in any case, we have a tight little place there, and right now we've got an ideal situation. The cookie jar has closed, and it's very tearful and so forth and nostalgic, but it's a lot quieter. We have Ray at the taking over Joe's service station, and he's doing an excellent job, and he closes at a decent hour, and I think we'd like to see that continue. As David said, any noise that you hear is tremendously affects our relationship. I mean, noise is inversely, it's the closer you are to something, the louder it is. And so if you've got a lot that's got a couple hundred feet, it's not as big a deal as it is when you've got 10 feet, 15 feet. So I just concerned about the precedent that you establish with VA zones and the fact that they might affect our VA zone, which is a lot different than the other.
Thank you.
Hello, my name's Angela Best. I live at 12 Pondview Road. I'm well acquainted with 77 since I take it every day. The B&B in question, one of your ordinance changes, you're asked to have some of the outside, have capability of having a facility on the outside. I ask that all bed and breakfast rooms to be for rent inside, not having, you know, keeping the rent inside opposed to having...
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble following you. I can't hear you very well.
For bed and breakfast, is the whole bed and breakfast to have, you go into the home and you stay and rent the home, but I read one of the changes was the possibility if you have an existing building on your site that it could be for rent. Did I read that wrong? But I would hate for that to happen with the B&B.
Yeah, I think the intent was to allow an existing building to convert to a bed and breakfast, having a slightly different set of standards than a brand new construction of a B&B.
Okay.
But I think what you're talking about is you want, if there's going to be one, you want all the rooms
yes.
to be within in a building as opposed to have separate cabins.
Yes, yes, that's what I would really like to see. And also the buffer zones, I mean, we do live in an area that has a little, our yards are a little bigger. But the setbacks, you know, 15, 18 feet, it's really not enough. I mean, if we're sitting out on our deck, I mean, we can hear the neighbors. I mean, it's just nature. But sometimes the setbacks, I think, should be larger, especially abutters for residential, if you're going to have non-residential. A bed and breakfast, I think the setbacks should be a little greater, should be more, some more buffering.
Can you state your name again so that we
Angela
can...
Best, B as in boy, E-S-T.
Thank you. Oh, you're right.
12 Pondview.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Joyce Wilson Sanford. I live at 1 Charles Road. And I just wanted to point out one difference because I was sitting here thinking if it's a good looking B&B, how is that different from just a house next door? And what does it mean in terms of noise or nuisance? And I'm here with neighbors. And what I want to say is that when you have a long-term invested relationship, when you live closely, you accommodate one another and make room for one another. Whereas if it's a B&B and it's people in and out, it's a very different feel as far as noise and how the house is used. There's no investment in the neighborhood. So even when last summer we were disturbed by the parties, it wasn't that they were wrong, it was they weren't in a neighborhood. They were visiting and ready to party. So I wanted to point out that difference. And also to say, and I think I said this last year, that at the boundary of a village or a town is where it begins to define itself. And so I really want careful strategic thought about that. We have kind of a precious little neighborhood, And in fact, I would like to see that focus sharpened so that there's an even more beautiful entry into Cape, and that there is a strategy about how you enter, and at what point does it become Cape Elizabeth, and not let it, through sloppy decisions, become a hodgepodge. So I ask for a strategic approach to the entry of Cape and to maintain this rather precious neighborhood.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
You described your relationship with your neighbor. I mean, if B&B were next door and the owner were living there at the time, do you feel that that relationship would continue?
I don't know.
Okay. Thank you.
I don't know.
Hi, I'm Maria Sorensen, 3 Dean Way, and I'm concerned about...
Could you say your name again, please?
Maria Sorensen.
Maria Sorensen. 3
Dean Way, and I'm concerned about the bed and breakfast setting a precedent for other people, the larger homes, to have bed and breakfast also. And even though the request is for one room, who's to say that next year they may come back for two rooms, three rooms, or use their out cabins or buildings as cabins for rental, too. I just foresee a snowball effect with this type of bed and breakfast. And we have a nice residential neighborhood where everyone knows each other, and the children play relatively safely, as safe as any children can. And I really don't want to see a bed and breakfast in our area. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes, Joe Faria, 2 Dean Way. Just to kind of second what Maria just finished to say, I mean, there's nothing to say that Carl is now requesting one room, and then if he's permitted to build a bed and breakfast, he can obviously have more rooms in the future. And there's just a precedent that when you start with something small and then you add to it, you know, my issue with bed and breakfast is one, safety for our children who play within feet of that property, and having one room probably wouldn't, he does have a big property, and one room probably would make a big difference. But my fear is what Maria already stated, that there's a cottage that was put in the back. We fear that might eventually become part of a bed and breakfast or something similar to that, and I just don't think that opening that precedent is good for our neighbor. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, Chair, ladies and gentlemen of the board, your residents. My name is Sean Tamir. I live at 1 Crescent View Avenue, right at Killer Cove. And I'm here today to advocate for a bed and breakfast, particularly for a very special bed and breakfast. And I was sitting here listening to my fellow residents and taking in their objections and more so their perception of what a bed and breakfast is. And I think I'm quite surprised, because I don't know how many of us have been to a bed and breakfast, but most bed and breakfasts I have been to and most bed and breakfasts that I'm aware of are always tucked in a nice, quiet residential area, always, to the best of my exposure, are upscale, are very quiet. Noise is never a factor. It's not about partying. When we go to bed and breakfast, I think we stay away from the hustle and bustle of hotels and motels and people coming in and out and partying and loud music and late night into sitting in the common area and sitting past 8, 9 o'clock. And I'm glad that I sat here and had given everybody an opportunity to come in and voice their opinion. But I don't see bed and breakfast as being that type of business, especially not for Cape Elizabeth. I mean, we are proud residents, and we look at our town as a place of pride and quietude and cleanliness and safety for our children. Where do our friends and family go when they come to visit us? Who comes to Cape Elizabeth, especially around Kettle Cove, Crescent Beach, to party? Who comes over there to be rowdy and create an unsafe environment to the residents if it's not our friends and family when they come here in the summertime? And in addition, friends and family would like to come over here around Christmas, around New Year's, and even later than that. We don't have that alternative. We don't have that outlet. A bed and breakfast is, in my opinion, a point of pride. A bed and breakfast is a place where we go to unwind after we've had dinner with our family, and we want to go to sleep because we want to get up early in the morning, and we want to have our coffee and take a walk down the beach. And I respect and appreciate the concerns of my fellow residents here about what would that bring into town? What sort of lifestyle are we going to trade what we have here for if we don't know whether or not Carr's going to have one room, two rooms, and then tomorrow 14 rooms? So all I'm saying that there is something that's called bed and breakfast, and it's kind of the overall under the umbrella of hospitality, which is, to me, a high-end, quiet, quality place to go and stay. And in this case of bed and breakfast in our town, there are really exceptions to the rule. To the rule of an area where we have density, where we have houses so close together, where we have houses that are really not that close to an arterial road or to a collector. The place, is anybody aware of One Crescent View Avenue?
Yes, I know.
Okay. Do you folks, are you aware of that? It's a unique situation for the fact that, first of all, it's an early 1800 circa Victorian that we don't see a whole lot around here. And it's situated right as you come in on 77. Is anybody familiar with the ice cream shop? Maybe I can pass on a little picture so people will get an idea of where it is. Do you folks mind?
I'm very familiar with it.
Yeah. I'm familiar with it.
You all familiar?
Yeah.
Is that okay if I pass this around?
Rick? We're going to ask you to try to be brief.
Yeah.
It's 10:30. We've been at it for 3.5 hours.
Trust me. I respect that, and I appreciate you staying here that late. And I was really looking forward to the opportunity to come here and present this to you because what we're proposing here is an amendment to what we have seen as a proposition here. This particular property is right across the street from an ice cream shop, a commercial shop. It is, a matter of fact, right off of the road which leads right into Kettle Cove Beach and adjacent to Crescent Beach. Okay, we are trying to retain a residential structure within the boundaries of what we're looking for. Okay, the changes that we're looking to make to this draft is not to create a huge business. We're looking to create something it's called soft.
Could you just speak to the, instead of speaking about your property, we're not looking at a site plan review.
Right, okay.
Just say, you know, I really like this. I'd like to see you have it be 1,000 rooms or whatever, but very brief, and not your property because we're not considering your property. We've read your email, and you want anything that's 100 feet from an arterial, and you want it to go up to 14 rooms. Is there anything else? I'm sorry, but, you know, we're all getting tired, and we're not going to be able to listen much longer, I think.
Well, then I'm not going to take any more of your time.
But is there anything else that you want to tell us other than the adjacent to an arterial and a larger number of rooms in general? just in terms of this proposal?
Well, it's hard for me to be too general, because this is really a specific place, and I think that the objection is to a bed and breakfast. And when you look at a situation such as that, yes, I agree. I should generalize. I don't know how many properties around Cape would be falling under the same umbrella if we would allow a place such as 1 Crescent View Avenue to be a bed and breakfast. So that's really why I'm looking at it as specific to what it is. Do you have any specific questions for me that I might be able to raise an awareness?
No, we're just looking at whether or not we're going to recommend anything generally, and what that's going to be, and what we're going to throw out, and what we're going to keep, and what weighing what everybody from the public has said.
Generally, I'm proposing a high-end, good quality, quiet, safe business that is right across the street from already a business zone that would actually bring the town pride as well as comfort and flexibility and hosting friends and family of us residents.
Mr. Tamir, I don't think anybody in the board is voicing an opinion either for or against your particular property.
Okay.
The goal of our public hearing tonight is to look at the overall standards that we're looking to implement or have a conversation around those overall standards. Barbara is absolutely correct. We've all read the email, and we appreciate what you have put forth. So we're not saying that we have an opinion one way or the other with regard to high-end or this specific property.
Right.
What we're really trying to do is solicit comment around the concept of a B&B and the proposal that we have. Currently, we have 6 rooms maximum. Mm-hmm. So you have requested a significant increase in that. Currently, we have frontage on an arterial or a collector. You've requested that any property located within 100 feet of that also be included. So what we're soliciting is there any other specifics as a general nature, not specific to your particular property, that you would like us to consider?
Sure. 2 of them. 1, that we revise the requirements for bed and breakfast to be within 100 feet of a collector or arterial.
Okay.
And the other one, they will be limited to 14 rooms.
Very good. Thank you.
Thank you for listening.
Is there anybody else who would? Wait, no. No 2 times. Sorry. I'm the boss. You can't speak twice.
Mark Pendarvis, 19 Kettle Cove Road. I own the ice cream shop. From the standpoint, after listening to everything this evening, I wasn't going to say anything, but I thought I would. These folks here were complaining about noise, but I believe that the town allows for rooms or homes to be rented. And that, in my opinion, causes much more noise than an upscale bed and breakfast. Because people come together, usually families rent a big home, and they do want to come to party. My experience with bed and breakfasts is, whether they're in Camden or I've stayed in some in the West End, they're very quiet. They're usually people that want to relax. Cape Elizabeth already has that atmosphere. And I agree that when you do cross over the border into South Portland, you definitely feel it and you know it. And I don't think that's what Carl and Sean here have proposed. So I would be in favor of bed and breakfasts that are upscale, that are regimented, that are very clearly defined, so that they don't have wild parties or they don't cause noise to a district. And whether it's 100 feet or 100 feet, 50 feet, I'll leave that up to the planning and the review and everything else, because I know you were just seeking general comments, and I came here only to give those. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Is there anybody else who has not spoken who would like to speak? If not, I'll close public hearing. Discussion on the part of the board, or?
Here's what I'd like to bring this back to a workshop, quite candidly. I've heard 2 things important to me tonight that I think caused me to want to kick it back to some more discussion. 1 is the concerns of people in different areas of the town that we might not have looked at as carefully in the Shore Road area. And then the second issue is my gut is telling me, you know, go from 6 to 14 isn't even close to where I was thinking this direction was going, and I don't intend to take it that way, but I want to discuss, you know, what that might mean in a different context, given that particular property. I mean, and I'm not it deserves more discussion than I think we can have here tonight, and that's why my motion would be to table this back to our next workshop.
And I'd like to address, there's a significant increase in the number of potential sites that would be utilized as a bed and breakfast, and based on that solely, I would like to bring it back to a workshop for an evaluation of the actual number of units that would be permissible.
Ready, yes?
If that's a motion, I'll second it.
We have a motion to table this to a workshop. Any discussion? All in favor? Thank you.
Thank you so much for your input. I'd like to move to adjourn.
Thank you.
Second.
All in favor?
I want you to know, I really value your comments. I didn't have my comments.